It's the Mixed Martial Arts Hour with
the Mixed Martial Arts Hour back in your life on this Monday, October 3rd, 2016. Hello again, everyone. I'm Ariel Helwani back inside our New York City studio. Great to be here on a wonderful Monday afternoon with you. Truth be told, I didn't think that I would be doing today's show because it's a very important day for my fellow Jewish people. Today is our New Year. Shana Tova to everyone out there. Maybe you're coming home from synagogue, from your prayers, from hearing the shofar, and you want to fire up the MMA hour while you're having your Rosh Hashanah lunch. Maybe. If you're not one of those people, then you're just enjoying the show on a typical, normal, uneventful Monday afternoon. But I do believe this is the first time in my history of being on this great earth that I'm working on Rosh Hashanah. It's a very important day for my people, but you know, there's so much going on in the world of MMA. I felt like I would be leaving you hanging. I felt like I wouldn't be doing my service to you as an MMA journalist, reporter, and host by skipping out on this show. So I am sacrificing you and my beliefs. Excuse me, I'm sacrificing me and my beliefs for you, the good MMA fans out there. Very happy to be here. So much going on in the world of mixed martial arts, and what a difference a week makes, right? I mean, this time last week, we were all kind of lamenting the state of UFC 205. I told you, if you recall, that in around 24 hours or so, we'll know a lot more. And in fact, it was less than 24 hours. It was around 6 or so hours after we said goodbye, UFC officially announcing that Eddie Alvarez would fight Conor McGregor, the main event of UFC 205 for the lightweight title. Shortly thereafter, they also announced Khabib Nurmagomedov versus Michael Johnson and Chris Weidman versus Yoel Romero. So three fights have been announced since we last spoke. And then they had that press conference in New York on Tuesday, which was absolute chaos in a good way. It was very entertaining. So much to unpack there. The card is official. Everyone feels good about it. The ticket prices are out of this world. A lot of people complain that they can't get tickets, but they have delivered on their promise to bring an outstanding card to Madison Square Garden. The card that MSG deserved, the card that New York City deserved, the card that this state deserved, the card that everyone who had been dreaming and hoping and wishing that New York State would finally legalize mixed martial arts. And once they did so, the UFC would bring a quote-unquote UFC 100 type card to the world's most famous arena. Well, they have surpassed UFC 100. I mean, it's UFC 100 plus 200 plus whatever 300 is going to be. It's fantastic stuff. So there's a lot to talk about there. The UFC had an event on Saturday in Portland, Oregon. A really entertaining main event. I guess somewhat controversial. It was close. We kind of figured it would be that way. In the end, John Lineker defeats John Dodson via decision. And there were some great results. How about... Well, actually, the co-main event wasn't... I mean, it was a solid win, obviously, for Cowboy Oliveira, but that was true controversy. That was one that left a sour taste in my mouth. Nate Marquardt coming back to Portland, Oregon. He is 3-0 in that building. He defeated Damian Maia in 21 seconds. Remember that? UFC 102. Then he won the Strikeforce welterweight title a few years ago over Tyron Woodley in that building. And then Saturday, he defeats Tamdan McCrory. All very spectacular finishes. Nate Marquardt does well in Portland, Oregon. And of course, the UFC is back this weekend. The big one, UFC 204, Michael Bisping against Dan Henderson. I actually just watched this documentary that the UFC put together on Michael Bisping called, I believe, Destiny or My Destiny. It is fantastic. I wish they did more of this kind of stuff. It's a 1 hour look at his journey since essentially day one, well before the UFC days. I actually shed a few tears while watching it. It was great. Got me very excited for what should be a memorable scene in Manchester this Saturday. So again, a lot going on. We've got a stacked show. We've got two champions, a Venezuelan vixen, a dream catcher, a crazy horse, and a lot more on this episode of the MAR. So let's get right into it and welcome in our first guest of the day. At around 4:10, we're going to be joined by Jason Perillo, who is the boxing coach for Michael Bisping, Chris Cyborg, and BJ Penn. What do those three fighters, on top of being coached by Jason Perillo, have in common? They're all fighting in the span of 4 weeks. an unbelievable stretch for Jason Perillo, who's in Manchester already for the Bisping fight this Saturday. So we'll talk to him about his success. One of the best coaches in the sport doesn't get, in my opinion, the credit that he deserves. 305, we'll take your questions and comments. New York Rick is back from his world travels, so I look forward to talking to him. At 245, the fighter formerly known as Crazy Horse Bennett, now known as Felony Charles Bennett, will stop by. You asked for him, you got him. He won at Ryzen last weekend, not this past weekend, the one before that. He is one of a kind. He is a unique figure in the world of MMA, very much in the news these days. So Charles Bennett will make his MMA Hour debut at 245. 225, we will talk to Juliana Pena about what's going on with her, her future. 205, Gegard Mousasi fighting in the second most important card on Saturday night against Vitor Belfort, a fight that is literally 7 years in the making, and we'll get into that. 145, the strawweight champion Joanna Jędrzejczyk will stop by to talk about her UFC 205 fight against Karolina Kowalkiewicz, Poland versus Poland. And then 125, Eddie Alvarez will stop by, talk about his very busy week, getting the fight, the press conference, all that stuff and more. But first, let us go to the Skype machine and welcome in my good pal, Sean Alshadi. There he is, as always, crystal clear Skype from Sean. How are you, my friend?
I'm doing well, man. How you doing?
I'm doing well. Great to talk to you. There's a lot to discuss. There's a lot going on between Saturday's card, this coming Saturday's card, 204, the 205 stuff. But first, obviously, we're doing an MMA show, and I would be remiss if I don't start on this note. Some very, very heartbreaking news. I mean, just gut-wrenching stuff coming out on Friday about UFC middleweight Josh Saman. Anyone who is a quasi-fan of this sport by now probably has heard his story. If you're a hardcore fan, you definitely have heard his story. I mean, everything that Josh has been through over the last few years, the passing of his girlfriend in particular in that car accident, and then him coming back and winning on her birthday at UFC 181, wrote a book about his life. He's been through so much. Then we come to find out on Friday that he is in a coma, that he's unresponsive, that a good friend of his and a local MMA cage announcer, ring announcer, PA announcer passed away. Details are very aren't very clear at this time. I just read an update courtesy of FoxSports.com and Damon Martin saying that he is still in a coma, so several days later. And you know what, to be honest, I don't really have a question for you. I mean, I just feel like we need to talk about Josh at the top of the show and just kind of send positive thoughts his way, because this is a guy who has obviously been through a lot, but a real credit to our sport. I mean, he writes for SB Nation. He writes for Bloody Elbow. He's just a smart, charismatic, great guy who has been through so much, and it incredibly depresses me to find out that he is in that state, and I'm just hoping and praying that he pulls through this.
Yeah, absolutely, man. It's a tragic story going on right now. I mean, anybody who knows Josh, anybody who's had interactions with Josh, I mean, he's a really wonderful person, man. I mean, there's a lot of fighters in this sport, and there's a lot of unique characters in this sport, but he really is someone who is so introspective and articulate. And, you know, he writes for our sister site, Bloody Elbow, and he does other writing gigs on the side. And he's just, it's very sad. It's very, very sad. All our hopes and prayers go out to Josh and his family, and hope that he pulls through this, because he is someone who's been through a lot. I think anybody who read The Housekeeper, his autobiography, can attest to it. I mean, he grew up, there's a lot of things that he had to deal with growing up, and then, you know, the death of his girlfriend, Haley, all within a very short time span. This is just a tragic turn of events, and we really do hope he comes out of this okay.
Yeah, well said, Sean. I last saw him in Atlanta for 201, and every time I talk to Josh or I see him write these fantastic articles, he just did a series of articles interviewing Jeff Nowitzki for UFC.com. Yeah. And he's a great writer. I mean, if you haven't read it, I mean, the book is just, I can never dream of putting together something like that. The guy's been through so much. I'm like, wow, look at him. Smile on his face, keeps going, in incredible shape, great fighter, has earned his place in the UFC, has really defied the odds and has overcome so much. And I hope he can do it one more time and then some, and come back to tell us all about it, because, you know, we are the MMA world is a much lesser place without him around. So we hope that he's able to pull through this, and we are definitely dedicating this show to him and hoping to send some positive thoughts his way. No easy transition to make there, but I will try my best. The UFC was in Portland, a very entertaining main event. Some people had it for Lineker. Some people had it for Dotson. Who'd you have it for?
Yeah, you know, it was a great fight, first of all. On first watch, I had it scored 3-2 for Lineker. I had gave Lineker 2-3-4, Dotson 1-5. And then, you know, I rewatched it this past weekend, yesterday. And I still had it 3-2 Lineker, but it was a lot closer on the second viewing. I think the round two seems to be the one that was the most divisive. And if you gave that to Dotson, I absolutely would not fault you for it. I could see this going either way. It really is a true toss-up. I mean, it comes down to what do you value more? Lineker's aggression and, you know, his willingness to be the bull in the situation, or Dodson's, you know, countering and you know, his ability to escape and continue to circle out and reset. And you see a lot of people going back to this running thing. Like, I don't know how this became a thing that is thrown around after these fights, but it's not running, man. He's resetting. It's a form of fighting. It's countering. It's silly to hear people say that he was running.
Okay, so you think that Lineker won. You think the judges got it right. So he's, you know, the rightful victor. We can move on. They're obviously not going to do a rematch. Bantamweight has become fascinating. And not just, you know, trying to figure out who Cruz is going to fight next. That's fascinating in its own right. But then, like, the next couple of fights under that, the contender fights, also very interesting. So if I say that the top guys right now at Bantamweight, let's say they're Dominic Cruz, TJ Dillashaw, Cody Garbrandt, John Lineker, Brian Caraway, and I don't know, maybe a Rafael Sunsal. Am I missing someone there as far as the top six are concerned?
Jimmy Rivera
coming off the eye injury, so I'm not really considering him, you know, a candidate right now for this year, but maybe he comes back sooner than later. Basically, if you're Sean Shelby, if you have the book, how are you booking those top three fights?
Dude, you really can't go wrong any way you do it right now. Bantamweight is so utterly fascinating. I think it's better than it ever has been. If you've given me the matchmaker hat, I would say that I would want Cruz versus Garbrandt, just because I feel like I want to see that fight at this point. There's a storyline there. Then Dillashaw, Lineker, to maybe see who gets the next shot.
Okay.
Although with John Lineker, it's so weird though, because it's like, if this guy continually fit five times not making weight, like, how, at what point can you just not trust him to give him that big spot? So he would have to give you some kind of guarantee that he's going to be able to make weight. I mean, missing 135 seems ridiculous for a guy his size. And then, you know, in that next level, I would go Caraway versus either Rivera if he can come back, or a Sunsal if he's still in it. Yeah.
You know what's fascinating about that division? They're not just fights at this point. And what I mean by that is Cruz has a story with Dillashaw and Garbrandt. So, you know, you can't really go wrong. I think there's more momentum behind Garbrandt. I think that's the bigger fight. But it's hard, as we said on Thursday, to argue against Dillashaw deserving the title fight, because he lost that fight back in January, you know, via the slimmest of margins. Lineker and Garbrandt have a history. Garbrandt and Dillashaw have a history. A Sunsal has a history. Well, he just lost to Dillashaw. So a Sunsal doesn't do a great job, let's be honest, of building himself up. But you get the point. They've got options. Yeah. Like if you do, if you do Cruz Dillashaw, Garbrandt versus Lineker was the fight that was supposed to happen this year. Garbrandt talking all kinds of smack about him on Twitter. I mean, finally, Bantamweight really coming together. They've done a fantastic. I maintain it's the most interesting division right now, because it's all a bunch of young guys vying. And then we get to the Sterlings of the world right after. It's great.
Sure. Almeida too, and you even have storylines with Caraway. It seems like anything
That's right.
Anything Caraway does, people are just going to crap on him. It seems ridiculous. He calls out John Lineker after watching this tremendous fight, and people are just piling on him. The guy.
Well, you don't really want that. Don't lie. You don't really want that fight. So I'm really curious to see what they do with all those top guys. Now, in the co-main event, we had Cowboy Oliveira defeating Will Brooks, but this was super, super controversial. I mean, Cowboy Oliveira misses weight by 5.5 pounds. And now with the new weigh-ins, you only get one shot to weigh in. So let's say it's, you know, 9 to 11 local time. If you weigh in at 9:05 and you miss weight, you don't get to do it again an hour later, like in the old days, or 2 hours later. He comes in like 20 minutes into the thing. So he still had an hour and 40 minutes or so to try to shed some of that weight. Didn't do it. They have a back and forth on Twitter. Will Brooks doesn't square off with him at the ceremonial weigh-in. Oliveira uses his size advantage to his advantage in the fight. Clearly, Brooks injures his rib. is hurt, blah, 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 loses the fight, and then Oliveira does the crotch chop, the DX crotch chop, the, you know, the Fangur thing, and says that he disrespected him, all this stuff. I mean, I had such a sour taste in my mouth after all that. I don't care whatever the guy said to you, what he did to you, you miss weight by 5.5 pounds and weighed in early. You don't get to say a thing, in my opinion. What do you make of all of this?
Yeah, I agree with you, and I think the unfortunate thing about Saturday's event is that it kind of left a bad taste on several moments. Because, I mean, you look at the main event and co-main event, the guy who won is the guy who missed weight. I mean,
that's a good point.
That's not what you want to see in this sport. But especially with Cowboy, I mean, missing 5.5 pounds is a lot, especially when the margins between these divisions are what they are. I mean, it looked like a welterweight versus a lightweight out there, if we're being honest with each other. And you're right. I mean, at that point, once you have already done that, like, you can't be the escalator. Like, you can't be the guy who after this is over, just starts, you know, doing all this and the cross chops and everything. It, like, you got to know your role at that point. Like, you won the fight, that's fine, but just kind of tone it down a little bit, man, because you're right. That's just not a good look. Like, he says that Will Brooks insulted me, therefore, you know, that I don't regret what I did. But it's like, man, Will Brooks insulted you because you insulted him by not making weight to that degree. Like, that's, you're putting him in a really hard spot. Like, he can turn down the fight, sure, but he doesn't know if he's going to get a show purse or a win purse or anything. Like, you're putting him in a very difficult situation. So, yeah, that left me with a sour taste.
It's also unfortunate that Lineker missed weight by 0.5 pounds. He gives up 20% to Dotson. Cowboy misses weight by 5.5 pounds, and he gives 20% to Brooks. I mean, there's no difference between 0.5 and 5.5. And also, like, I kind of feel like at this point, the days of the win bonuses should go away. Like, these are professional athletes, and there are always going to be bonuses for performance and stuff. In baseball, you hit 200 innings, 300 strikeouts. I don't know what it is, but there's always going to be, you know, performance. But if you make it to fight night, you should get paid what you should get paid. I mean, like, the days of win and show, these guys don't need extra motivation. So I'm sure that Will Brooks, who just got married, who just had a baby, is saying, like, look, I can't afford to turn down this fight. I just did a whole training camp. I can't afford to say no. What am I gaining if I say no? I'm getting nothing. He ends up losing. I wish they would do away with the win bonus. Everyone just gets paid the full amount. And I also wish that, you know, if you miss weight by more than 2 pounds, 3 pounds, it's more than 20%. It's 50%.
Yeah, I would agree with you. I think the win bonus system it seems very archaic at this point.
Yes.
And especially because you see it now. I mean, even the champions and the guys who get farther up, they don't have win bonuses.
No.
They just flat fee. I mean, most of the headliners at this point, Connor and Nate and all these guys, will just have a flat fee, and then they'll get whatever bonuses they get on it. And also, I agree with you on the tiered system. I mean, I would like to see some level of tiered system where if you miss weight by a pound or less, it's a certain percentage, and then, you know, anything higher, it's a higher percentage. Because it just seems it's almost the same argument as the rounds, where it's like a 10-9 where somebody gets a knockdown and is pretty definitively winning should not be the same as a 10-9 where it's ultra close and razor thin. Like, there should be levels to this game on all across the board. I agree with you there.
And the performance bonuses are nice, and I'm not going to complain about, you know, them giving someone something that they didn't have in their contract. But it does kind of suck for John Dotson, who, in my opinion, was a part of the best fight of the night, doesn't get a bonus because Lineker, per their rules or whatever, these arbitrary rules, isn't eligible. So, you know, like, it's like, man, not only did he lose, not only did the guy miss weight, now he's not eligible for what would have been his bonus, I think, right? Yeah. Was there a better fight than that?
Yeah, no, and through no fault of his own.
Yeah.
He didn't do anything wrong. He was professionally crazy. Made weight. He's not eligible. This is one of the situations where you would hope they're taking care of him in the back room, but we have no idea and we'll never know.
Right. Okay, let's talk about New York City, UFC 205. Fantastic card. What did you think of the press conference on Tuesday? I mean, I may be a little biased because I was there, so I was part of the whole energy. You were watching it from your computer. How did it come across in your opinion?
I think it came across beautifully. I mean, it seemed like it was just full of energy, and it was. It felt historic. It felt like we've been waiting for this for years at this point. And I think you guys have talked about it already, where it's just for several weeks, for several months at this point, it felt like this was going to be anticlimactic, and we weren't going to be able to reach the heights that we thought this card should be. And then all of a sudden, within like 24 hours, things turned on a dime, and it got crazy. And the press conference felt like it should. It felt pretty historic, and it felt, you just see all of those guys and the faces and names up there, and it's just like, this is an unbelievable lineup. Like, this is really just a very cool moment. And then there were also little snippets of things throughout that you could just take through. It was pretty cool.
The reveal of everyone standing behind that curtain, the curtain comes up, and then the crowd's chanting UFC, which is a very rare thing for a press conference. It was very ECW-esque, if you get what I'm saying. That, to me, was one of the coolest non-fight moments in UFC history. Like, all these amazing fighters, champions, former champions, future champions, contenders, big names, Conor, after everything they've been through, after getting the deal done, essentially at the 11th hour, that was so freaking cool. Now, one of the big things coming out of that press conference was the Jeremy Stephens interaction. I mean, it made it on Jimmy Kimmel Live, which is a victory in its own right for the UFC, but Jeremy Stephens was the butt of everyone's jokes. I maintain that that was a victory for Jeremy Stephens, too. He is now a part of the Conor McGregor story. If he knocks out Frankie Edgar or gets a big win and gets on the mic and says, you know who I am, Conor, you will respect me, you will know my name, I think he has a better chance than most of getting that fight now because of that interaction.
I would agree with you on that regard, that it certainly has pushed him into the Conor storyline. And you're right. There's a way he could parlay that to his favor if he does manage to have a really good performance on November 12th and just knocks out Frankie and turns it around, kind of flips the script on it. But, man, if he loses, like,
it's going to be... If he loses.
Not all press is good press type of situation.
But in this case, I think it was good because how many times have we seen those Conor press conferences now where he's sitting there up there with everyone? And no one says a thing. No one says a thing, including people who are, you know, very closely tied to him. Cowboy, Frankie over there. No one's saying a thing. This guy took a chance.
Yeah, hey, Jeremy saw his moment.
Yes.
And he wanted to capitalize on it, and you can't fault the guy for that. I ultimately end up coming away from that. I feel bad for the guy because, I mean...
I still don't feel bad for him. I think he just talked himself into a potential money fight, believe it or not.
If you're coming at a firefight with Conor, like, I feel like you got to bring your best stuff. And I don't think he was prepared enough for that, man.
Now, I will say Conor's delivery, his reaction, like taking the beat, looking over and then saying what he said, was pretty damn brilliant. I mean, he has no contemporary.
The leprechaun and the oh good one is the one that really sold it. It's just like, oh, man.
At this point, it's pretty safe to say that if Conor is not on the card, it doesn't feel as big. Like, he ups the ante that much more than anyone. Like, I think a Conor McGregor card, and this is just the truth, Conor McGregor card against anyone, Mr. X, Jeremy Stephens, Eddie Alvarez, Jose Aldo, feels bigger than any other potential card that they could put together with the biggest names possible, including Ronda Rousey. He just brings something different to the table, from the press conferences to the media to the fight, everything.
I agree with you, and I think it's interesting the level of dialogue we've gotten in regards to a Conor McGregor press conference now is a different type of dialogue that takes place in any of the press conferences. You have him taking shots at Eddie Alvarez for not renegotiating his contract. Like, all of these different nuances to the behind-the-scenes stuff, he brings it out and just talks about it in a very matter-of-factly way. And I think that's interesting because I can't think of anybody else who ever really does that.
No, it is unprecedented.
You're right. It adds a different level of, like, everything feels big around him. But I would say that I think maybe a Ronda Rousey return might feel big. Don't know yet. We have no idea.
No, I know. It's just the way he acts at the press conferences, and he riles people up and he feeds off the crowd. This is not me being a Conor nut hugger. This is me being a realist. Anyone who refuses to recognize this at this point, you're just blind. I don't know why. You're jealous. I don't know what it is, but you got to face facts. Now, the flip side to all of this, there's a few unhappy fighters, most notably Jose Aldo, who wants to be released. How do you think this plays out? Do you think he gets what he wants? Does he get the release? Or is this just his way of trying to get more money, a favorable fight? What do you think happens to Jose Aldo in the UFC?
I don't think this is his way of trying to get more money. I mean, that guy does not strike me as a guy who cares so much about money to where he would make this a thing over money. I think he genuinely feels slighted and genuinely feels like he was disrespected. And I think that's more important to him than anything. But the UFC is a business, man. And we always come back to this. The UFC is ultimately a business, and they're going to do what's best for business. I think it'd be insane for them to cut or to release the greatest featherweight of all time, probably. Like, it's Bellator or World Series or ONE FC. All of these organizations would jump at the opportunity to sign a guy like Jose Aldo. I mean, he's a top 10 guy in the history of our sport. It's very sad to see kind of what it's sad to see what's happened to Jose, to be honest, because I mean, it shows you how one performance can really change the way everybody's going to look at you forever. Because I mean, the 13 seconds, like, no matter what this guy does now, it always comes back to 13 seconds. And that's such an immense disservice to the legacy of this tremendous athlete that we've seen compete in unparalleled for like virtually 10 years, but one bad performance and now all of a sudden he's a bum. It's sad to see it. It's unfortunate.
And it has been brewing for quite some time, this rift between him and the UFC. I do agree. Yeah. I hope that they figure it out. I don't know what's going to happen, but I don't think that this is him playing games. I think he is being very genuine when he says he wants out. One last thing before I let you go. 204 Saturday, Manchester, Bisping's first title defense against Dan Henderson. Are you into this? Some people are still holding on to the fact that Henderson should. I'm kind of into it. Like I bought in. Why not? Right? It's fun.
It's 2016 and Michael Bisping's the UFC middleweight champion, man. Anything goes at this point.
It is wild. It'll
be interesting to watch. I mean, we're used to seeing Bisping in the underdog role.
Right.
And now he's the favorite. He's going into this fight expected to win. Like, and he's in his home. He's in England. I don't know. There's interesting dynamics to it.
Plus, the whole Dan Henderson, you know, retirement thing, which I can't imagine him winning and then walking away. But, okay. I mean, that is interesting in its own right. Who's your pick?
I lean Bisping now.
Okay.
It's early, but I'm still leaning Bisping.
All right. Fair enough. Great stuff as always, Sean. Thank you.
Absolutely. I appreciate it, man. Thank you.
I appreciate your time. There he is, Sean Alshadi, one of the very best in the business. Great insight from him as always. All right. Front and center, Tuesday afternoon in New York City, was Eddie Alvarez, the UFC lightweight champion. He got the fight that he wanted. He's fighting Conor McGregor at UFC 205, November 12th, Madison Square Garden. But he is joining us first on the phone right here. How about this? Very exciting stuff. Eddie Alvarez on line number one. Eddie, are you there?
What's up, Ariel?
How are you, sir?
I'm excellent, man. Couldn't be better.
Lot to talk to you about, my man. This time last week, Eddie, I was doing this show, and you didn't have a fight. And we were all wondering, what's going to happen? Is the fight that everyone wants going to end up on this card? Blah, 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 blah. You know, late Monday, we get word, it's a done deal. In the end, how'd you get it done? How'd you get the fight that you wanted?
But I don't know if there was a little bit of gamesmanship on UFC's part. I don't know if they were, you know, they're sending some bad agreements to other fighters and things like that. I think, I don't know what was going on. It seemed like a whirlwind. And Monday, I believe it was Monday when I was on my way to Mark Henry's house, I got a text 3 o'clock in the morning from Dana saying to give him a call. And I know the press conference was on, you know, the following day. So I had an idea that this might be the call. And so I got on the phone with him and I said, hey, what's up, man? And he started to talk to me about, you know, the same stuff about that was going on in the news about the Khabib things and Jose Aldo. And I think I just stopped him in his tracks, and I was like, look, man, like, nobody wants these fights. And that's not what I'm being told. That's not what anybody's being told. So I said, let's stop all this. I'm coming to New York, and let's make this fight happen. And Dana took the meeting. My managers came in, and you know, we got the deal done that night.
So at any point in all of this, as we're approaching that press conference, it kind of felt like a deadline. Like, were you worried that you weren't going to get this opportunity? Because as you said, UFC is sending out bout agreements. They're saying that you missed a deadline for this and that. Conor's relatively quiet. You know, no interviews on his end, no real posts on social media. Like, were you nervous, or were you always kind of calm, cool, and collected that in the end this is going to work out in my favor?
I was nervous. My management didn't seem to be. My management was very reserved, very, you know, they dealt with it very good. I was actually shocked to see how well they dealt with it. So they kind of called it. They knew what they were doing, and the deal got done. But yeah, I was going back and forth in my own head, but at the end of the day, as long as I woke up every morning and got ready to fight, it didn't really matter what happened.
this fight is less than 2 months away, but, you know, it had been brewing for quite some time. Rare for a fight this big to come together this late. So were you already preparing for Conor, hoping that it gets done at some point so that you could be ahead of the curve?
I was preparing. Didn't have to be necessarily for Conor. I was just preparing, I think, maybe 6 weeks ago, just back in the gym, back with my strength and conditioning coaches. We started probably sparring weeks ago as well. So when this was announced, I was already in a camp, already preparing, already getting ready to be conditioned, to be ready to fight on MSG, and if not MSG, on the Toronto card.
In the end, would you have been okay with fighting Khabib, or was it Conor or bust for you? Like, if you didn't get this Conor fight, would you have waited for a more favorable date or some other card? What were you thinking as far as options?
Well, I didn't know how serious to take them when they're saying, like, originally telling us, like, Conor wasn't the fight. I didn't really know how serious to take them because I heard otherwise. So I was pretty sure that this fight was happening. They wanted it. Conor wanted it. And, you know, I wanted the fight as well. So I don't even think there was any other names in question. I think they were just brought up as sort of a, you know, a little game that everybody plays when they go to negotiate fights and stuff. So, no, I don't, no hard feelings on my part. You know, it's part of the game. I think this was always a fight. I think everybody involved and everybody knew this was always a fight.
Does a part of you feel bad for Khabib in the sense that it sort of feels like he was used as a pawn in all of this?
No, I don't feel bad for fighters.
Okay.
I don't. I mean, like, if something tragic happens in fighters' families and things like that, I feel terrible. As far as the fight business and what goes on, I don't feel bad for fighters. We play a game and there are no rules and you got to learn how to play it and you got to learn how to play it to the best of your ability. But we're all in the same game, so just sit and feel sorry. There's no time for any of that.
Do you think Khabib got played?
Yeah, a little bit. Yeah, I'd say so.
So then you end up at this press conference, you know, less than 24 hours after you make this deal, and it's an unbelievable scene. It's like straight out of a Jerry Springer show times 100. People are chanting, you know, booing. I mean, I'll never forget it. And there you are. Is it like, what is it like for you? Because, you know, there was a point where it got a little hairy. You said you're nervous. You're sitting there looking at all of us, looking at the crowd. Are you pinching yourself? Is it surreal? Like, how are you taking this in and not getting too emotional? Because I thought you did a good job at the press conference. It's kind of a new territory, even though you've been in this sport for so long. This is a different kind of beast. What are you saying to yourself to take this all in?
Whenever there's moments like that, I sort of become the spectator. You know, I just tell myself to have a good time and enjoy the show. I become a spectator. I'm no, like, I try to put myself out of the spectacle realm and put myself as a spectator and enjoy the show. And I truly did. I enjoyed the press conference. I had a fun time with it. I thought it was different for me. I think it was a good time for me. I had a fun time.
So if the press conference was a fight, a performance, how do you think you did? Are you happy with your performance?
Maybe like a 5 out of 10.
Oh, wow.
I would have liked to have been prepared. I wasn't prepared because we just made the deal the night before. And if I was going into that sort of realm where I know guys talk shit, I would have been prepared, like, fully to, you know, basically win the whole thing. But the fact that I wasn't sure whether I was going to fight and that we just got the deal done the night before, I wasn't going to stay up all night making notes. I thought it was more important just to be genuine and just say how I felt, whether it came out, however it came out, just say how I felt when I felt it.
So one of the big takeaways from the press conference, as you know, is Conor coming out and sort of mocking you for the deal that you cut. Was that a low blow?
Mm-hmm. A low blow?
Yeah.
On me?
Yeah. Did you feel like he crossed some sort of, I don't know, invisible line?
No, no. I don't. I'm happy with the money that I'm ready to make. I think you have to earn the right to be able to draw a line in the sand and say, this is what I want. And I think fighters need to be prepared to walk if you're willing to, if that's the case. And I don't think this was one I was prepared to walk away from. I think it's too sweet. I think the opponent, it's too good of a style matchup opponent. The money's good. Everything about the fight is good. It wasn't one I was willing to walk away from at this time. So I wasn't going to sit there and nickel and dime the UFC about negotiating the deal. The deal was good. The deal's fine. I'm fine by it.
Were you surprised that he had that information? And if so, how do you think he got it?
A little bit surprised. Yeah, I don't know if he should be having stuff like that, or he should know things like that about how much money I'm making and things of that sort. I don't know who told him or what was what, but I know management teams talk in order to get deals done, and so maybe it was the management teams talking, letting them know what each other got done and what they have to do to get the fight done itself. So, but what does he give a shit? I mean, I don't care. He seemed like kind of a little angry about it, right? I don't know why he was so angry about it. He seemed like upset about that I took the deal. It was a little weird to me.
You think he was hoping that you wouldn't?
Yeah, I don't know if there was a stipulation, like if I asked for more money, that the fight's off or something. Maybe he wanted the fight to be off. I don't know. I'm not sure. He just seemed a little bit angry about it.
What were you guys saying to each other when you were squaring off?
Dana was putting the belt on him, and I told him, yeah, give him the little boy belt. I said, you take that little boy belt. And he got mad about that. That pissed him off a little bit that he had the smaller weight class belt.
Given
and
the
he puffed his chest up,
right,
and tightened his pants up, and he got real tall.
Given the reaction from the crowd, do you think that you're going to get booed on November 12th?
Yeah, I mean, given the reaction of that crowd, yeah, it kind of was weird because I definitely didn't expect that as far as the boos, but it just sort of reiterated to me, what his fan base is. You know, his fan base is him. There are people who there's just, it's all perception. It all is. It seems like he has a lot of WWE fans, like guys who don't know much about fighting at all. They just like they like him. So you can have them fans. They're not the fans I want anyway. You know what I mean? Like I get booed all day long because I don't want a fan who don't know shit about MMA. I'd rather have a fan who knows the sport, who enjoys the sport, and sees and can see value.
Your run in the UFC thus far is pretty much unprecedented, you know, given the people that you have fought. Cowboy, Gilbert, Pettis, RDA, and now Connor. Honestly now, no one's listening. Do you truly believe that Connor is the easiest of that bunch as far as opponents and the test that he presents to you is concerned?
Yes, 100%. Wow. No one's listening. I do.
Why?
I do. I know. Why do I?
Yeah, what makes you think he's so easy?
I think every other one of them opponents that you mentioned have their well-rounded skill set, and even if the fight goes to another realm of MMA where you're going from standing up to ground to jiu-jitsu. Everyone's tough in each one. They're well-versed to the point where they can hang with some of the toughest guys in the world in any aspect of the sport. And I don't think he can. I don't know. From what I've seen, and not only that, the conditioning aspect is it's just not a good level of conditioning. The last Nate Diaz fight was a very big eye opener for me. So I truly sincerely feel. Usually when I square off with a man, my heart rate goes up. I feel something. I never felt so unthreatened by a human being when I was up on stage with him.
Wow. Nothing he does concerns you.
That's a God's honest truth. I never felt so unthreatened by another man.
And it's been a long career for you.
It's been a long career. Long.
Okay, so the next 7 or so weeks, probably going to be nuts. You're going to be pulled in many different directions. Are you prepared for this? How are you going to handle this road to 205? Because speaking of that long career, you've never been a part of anything. I mean, none of us have been a part of anything like this. This is going to be, I mean, this is historic stuff. The first show at MSG, et cetera. You don't need me to tell you. Mentally, how are you going to deal with all the other stuff outside of just preparing for the fight, which is the easiest for you?
I have a lot of practice along the way. I know what to keep first. I know how to prioritize. I know how to keep things. I know how to keep what's most important, keep that important, and make sure that I'm being accountable, being responsible, and doing everything that I need to do to win the fight. I've had a lot of practice, a lot more than him, a lot more than other guys in this division. So it's not going to be a concern of mine going into this. There's no reason why I can't get up, why I can't continue to, no matter how much media obligation or what's going on, why I can't continue to work on the game plan, work on my art, and be conditioned and be ready to go in there and fight.
Sometimes we see Conor talk about other opponents, you know, he gets under their skin. I think it worked with Jose Aldo. Has he said anything thus far to piss you off, to get under your skin? Are you worried that you might fight too emotionally?
No way. not even a little bit.
Okay.
Like I was being completely honest with you when I said I enjoyed the press conference. I don't take anything personal. If you know me as a person, even when someone's like trying to be like legitimately malicious to me and saying things to me, it's really, really hard for me to take things personal from anyone. I just kind of enjoy the show, and I think that's what I'm going to do November 12th. I won't get too emotional about anything, and the job will get done. It'll get done violent and quickly, and I'm not sure. Are they going to boo or are they going to cheer? I don't know what's going to go on, but I know my people coming up from Philadelphia, they're going to be going nuts.
Well, speaking of that, he was asked a couple times his prediction. I don't think you were asked yet. Do you have an official prediction?
A prediction for the fight?
Yeah, how do you see it going down? How do you see it playing out?
We'll have to see.
Do you see something yet, or is it too early? Because you said violent and early. No. I just heard you say that.
Look, I'm not... Fights are unpredictable. We're not quite sure what's going to happen. I'd be lying just like he is if I went and spit something out. He made his prediction after I got him angry, which was, it's a telltale sign that his prediction was forced. It wasn't something he thought. He just made it up because he got angry.
Hmm. So there's no vision that you see right now as far as the way the fight is going to play out.
You guys will all see the vision on November 12th, and it'll be a beautiful image.
Are you bringing in anyone? Is it the same crew that you're going to be training with? Are you doing anything different for this one?
Yeah, we have. Well, I got one of the best southpaws in Philadelphia, Ray Robinson. And he's been not just a training partner, but a friend of mine for a long time. He's been with me pretty much every day, going to sparring, and we're using him for sparring. I also using him to watch film, watch tape, and things of that sort. He's one of the slickest southpaws in Philadelphia. And we have someone flying in this week, actually. We got a little treat this week, I believe, on Thursday. I think we have someone coming in that was going to be with us for like about a month or so.
Oh, surprise? You can't tell us who?
I'm not even sure who he is. Mark ordered him.
Oh, okay. Is there a website for that?
Yeah, you just order Exploring Partners. Now Mark was really into one certain guy, and my management got on it right away and made sure we got him over here. So,
did you get a chance to go into MSG to look around? Did you do anything there?
Yeah, we did some filming Thursday or Wednesday, where we shot the promo and things like that, and it was it's surreal, man. What a cool ass event. it seems like sort of intimate, and I don't know, man. I'm gonna enjoy myself for sure.
Well, it's amazing to hear you describe it that way. What a cool ass event, and you're the freaking headliner. You're the guy on the poster. This, like, to me, this is one of the best stories of the year. That Eddie Alvarez, considering everything that you've been through, you know, the ups and downs, fighting the Underground King. The Underground King makes it on the marquee of the most anticipated event in UFC history. There is some beautiful poetry in there. You see what I mean? Like, you and maybe I'm a little biased now that I got to see where you're from and the humble beginnings. This is an amazing thing, what has transpired here. It truly is. It's a beautiful thing.
I'm excited, man. lot of big things going on, and after November 12th, when we let the world know what's what and we get some things sorted out, I guess people will think I'm really important. I'm really good at fighting after that.
What do you mean? What do you mean? What do you mean when we sort some things out after November 12th? What are you alluding to?
No, not alluding to anything. I'm just saying we'll get this fight sorted out and let people know who's the better of us two. And once that gets sorted out, people understand that there's a lot more to fighting than Conor McGregor.
And that's when you ask for the new contract, right?
Yeah, we'll see. I don't know. Well, Connor seems to know a lot about my contract. Maybe I'll have him renegotiate.
Last thing, if you don't mind me asking, could you give us a ballpark how much you expect to make from this fight, since it's such a big deal?
Millions.
Millions. So anyone who's worried about how much Eddie Alvarez is making, they should stop worrying.
Don't be so worried. It's my money anyway. You can't have any of it.
I bet everyone's coming out of the woodwork now, right? Asking for tickets and all that. Are any of your people left out?
What's that?
Because people have been complaining that the tickets are too much, or they can't get tickets. They sold out. Are people hitting you up already?
I got more ticket texts and emails and everything. Hey, I got an email from Joey from Friends. I guess his people.
What?
About some sort of ticket situation, and I thought that was funny.
They're asking you for tickets?
I don't know. I don't quite know what it was. One of my old management said, "Hey, you had an email from Matt LeBlanc's people, Joey from Friends."
That's incredible.
And I need to answer them guys back. I wasn't sure exactly what they wanted. But I think I had to do regarding tickets.
Have you ever met him?
No, I don't.
That is hilarious.
I'm a huge fan of Friends. Me and my wife watch it all the time.
You gonna hook him up?
If I'm hooked up, then I'll be more than happy to share.
If you walk out with Joey from Friends, I mean, this event just got a whole lot bigger, in my opinion.
Yeah. I emailed him back. You know what I emailed him back?
What?
How are you doing?
Look at Eddie Alvarez calling the shots now, putting Matt LeBlanc in his place. I love it. A beautiful thing. Well, again, I'm really happy for you, man. Enjoy this ride. It's a pretty short one for such a big fight, but something tells me it's going to get a whole lot crazier. It's going to get a whole lot bigger than anything any of us have ever been a part of. So enjoy it, and I wish you the best in training, and I look forward to seeing you on November 12th. Thank you for doing this.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Thanks, Ariel. All right, later.
All right, there he is, Eddie Alvarez, the UFC lightweight champion, stopping by. It doesn't get any bigger than November 12th for him as he faces Conor McGregor. Now, just a few seats down from Eddie Alvarez, last Tuesday in New York, sat the UFC strawweight champion, Joanna Jędrzejczyk. She is also on the UFC 205 card, and she is joining us on the phone right now. Joanna, how are you?
Hi, guys. How are you doing? I'm good.
Thank you for coming on. Usually we see you on Skype, but this time it's on the phone, just your voice.
Yeah, we're having some problems.
Oh, that's okay. I know you're very busy, so I appreciate you coming on and talking to us, regardless of whether it's Skype or the phone. Now, let me ask you first, when you got the call that you were fighting on this card, because you made it known that you wanted to be on the first ever card at MSG, what was your reaction when you got the call that you were going to be fighting in New York?
I asked for this fight long time already, you know, so I was happy that maybe a week before the press conference, I heard that I'm going to be on this card. So I was very happy. Like, I was like, finally, you know, finally, and let's do this. Can't wait for this show.
You got on the card before Conor and Eddie got on the card. When you were on the card as it was, when it looked for a minute like it was going to be, you know, the Tyron Woodley fight and your fight, did you think this was big enough for MSG, or were you hoping that Conor would get on the card as well?
No, I didn't expect Conor on this card but I was super happy when I heard about. But the thing was that I said to my people that there is something going on, you know, like Dana and UFC, that they have some ace in the pocket, and I was waiting for that, you know.
What was that press conference like for you, being a part of it? Unfortunately, you didn't get asked a lot of questions. Usually you get a lot of questions, but this time with all the craziness, you weren't asked all that much.
Yeah, but when there is a Conor on the press conference, there is no more question to other fighters.
Yes. Does that bother
but
you?
But I was happy, you know. I like I like New York. I'm not here to talk. I'm here to train hard and fight very hard. That's all. But the reaction of my fans was amazing. So I was more than welcome, and I was happy because of that.
The last time you were in New York, you weren't as big of a star as you are now. And as we told you when you were in studio, there's a big Polish community here in New York. Did you feel the love last week when you were here walking around? Did you get a nice reception from the people of New York?
Yes, I got that. So it was amazing, really. Like, so many people recognized me in Florida and in New York, and this is amazing, you know. I like that.
You know what I was thinking when you were squaring off with Karolina? I was wondering if for the first time in your UFC career, you were trash talking in Polish, because she understands Polish. Of course, she's from Poland. Were you talking to her in Polish or in English?
English. Oh. No, I'm international. I'm international champion. And I don't know if she could understand me or not, but I don't mind, you know.
What were you saying to her?
That the shit got real and be ready.
Do you think that she's on your level as far as fighting is concerned?
She's not, but she's a tough chick, so it's going to be a really tough and interesting fight, but she's not on my level.
Is there anything that she does that impresses you?
No, I'm not impressed of Karolina Kowalkiewicz.
As far as your UFC fights are concerned, where do you put her? Is she tougher than anyone you fought in the UFC? Is she not as tough as anyone you fought? Like, where do you put her as far as your test thus far in the UFC?
You know, she deserved to fight for this title. She beat Rose, and she's supposed to be my next opponent, but Karolina won, and here we go. She's a challenger.
How do you feel about fighting a fellow Polish fighter? Sometimes I hear from Brazilians, they don't like to fight fellow Brazilians. Canadians say the same. What about you? There's so few Polish fighters in the UFC. How do you feel about fighting against another one?
It's my business. It's my business. It's my job. I don't mind who is going to be my next opponent, or who is Karolina. She can be from Cuba and I'm still going to fight her, you know. She can be from my city and I'm still going to fight her if I have to fight.
When did you first meet Karolina?
I met Karolina in 2012, amateur competition in Poland. I submit her in the third round.
No, but like not in terms of fight. I know you fought, but like just in gyms or events. Like, is that the first time you ever met her?
I know. What okay. You're asking for. I met her in the lobby, you know, and she was super nice, super cute. She came to me with her coach. They hugged me. They were talking to me, but then she wasn't nice. She isn't real person. That's her problem, you know. She's fake person.
Oh, really? Why do you say that?
Because before my fight with Gadea, we used to record some video for our sponsor. We had photo shoot together, and she was super nice. We were talking a lot, but after her fight with Rose, she said lots of bad things, and that's the reason, you know.
What did she say that bothered you?
That I'm afraid of her and that I'm going to lose my belt. Hey, come on. Must be serious.
And then, of course, so you fought her, as you said, around...
There's no trash talk, you know, but she's fake. And I'm going to prove to all of you that she's a fake person.
Did she say anything back to you when you guys were squaring off?
No, I don't know if she could understand me.
Right. And you've been, like, now you fought in front of the biggest crowd in UFC history in Melbourne. You've had some, you know, the International Fight Week. Do you think that all of this is going to be a little too much? She's never fought on any kind of stage like this before.
I don't know. She fought on big UFC shows. I don't know. I know that she never... fought with someone like me in her pro MMA career.
Right. Okay. Now here's the big thing. You're in Florida right now, right?
Yes, I'm part of ATT.
Okay. How did you end up at ATT? Why did you leave your team and end up there?
You know, I'm still in good relation with my team, my old coaches, but I felt that I need to change something in my life. I ended up in Florida at ATT, and I'm very happy to be part of family of American top team. Good people around me, very good coaches, top level fighters, and the weather is nice.
Yes, it definitely is. Now, are you living in Florida full time or just for the camps?
Just for the camps, you know. Like, I have my family back home in Poland, so I want to make my life here in US. I want to spend more time in US, but definitely I love Poland and I'm still Polish, you know.
I remember a few months ago you were kind of going to different camps, like Jackson's. You went to ATT, I think you were in California. In the end, was that kind of your way of seeing what was the best fit? Were you sort of scouting the teams back then? And in the end, why did you feel
no,
like
it wasn't? Wasn't it? I had some job to do, and I was not looking for a new camp at that time.
So why did you decide that ATT was the best one for you?
I don't know. I was looking for good spot, you know, for good people, good coaches, good facility, and here I am in Florida, you know. So my nutritionist, my doctor is here, perfecting athletes, other people, so I'm very happy to be here.
When was the last time that you prepared for a fight outside of Poland, if ever?
Never happened.
Wow.
Before.
Does it feel weird or do you feel comfortable?
Yeah, like the trainings are different a little bit, but very high level. So I'm very happy. I know how to push myself, you know what I mean? So I'm in good spot. I'm in good hands. My head coach is Mike Brown.
Mike, yes, I saw you guys together. There's few coaches better than Mike Brown. What a great guy he is. And Will Brooks actually told us on the show last week that he was blown away by how hard you train in the gym. There are so many big fighters there.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah. Will Brooks said that he was looking at you. Yeah. Any fighter in particular that really impressed you, that came up to you and said, welcome to the team, you know, if you need anything? Has there anyone of the, you know, the big names at ATT, because there's so many, that has gone out of their way to make you feel comfortable?
I like the way how the fighters respect each other, you know. So I heard lots of good things. Like I was more than welcome. Everyone is very helpful. So yeah, like I said, it's a very good place to be.
And I have to be honest with you, Joanna, almost every day I get another manager calling me and telling me, did you hear that Joanna is a free agent now? That, like, every single manager in this game wants to represent you. Is it
true? I'm waiting for a good offer, you know, bring me some money and that's all what I want from my manager, you know.
So what happened with your...
I'm here, I'm in US, we can work on this field more, you know.
You're going to get like 20 more phone calls now. Everyone's like, how do I get in touch with
her? Oh, really?
Oh my gosh. Somehow the word got
talk
out.
Talk to her.
Yeah.
Give me her number.
Somehow the word got out and everyone wants to sign you. But let me ask you, why did you part ways with your former management team?
We still friends, you know. I like Thiago Camura so much, but I decided to change something in my life. You know, sometimes you need to change something in your life, you know, to go harder, you know.
Mm-hmm. Have these changes?
I want to work with the best people in the world because I'm the best in the world. I want to retire as a champion, and this is my goal. This is my dream, and mark my word, because I'm going to do this.
Have these changes been brewing for a long time? Like, did you feel like you needed to make these changes since before the Claudia fight?
Yes and not. It was a really quick decision.
Wow. So there's a lot of changes
going on.
I've got
really good offer. There is more things coming out, but I'm very happy to be here.
What else is coming out?
It's a secret. Come on, I can tell you everything.
but there's a lot going on, a lot of changes in your life. Like, this has all happened before the biggest fight on the biggest card.
People are afraid of changes, you know. They are afraid to change something in their life, but they like to complain. I don't like to complain. I like to work, you know. So it wasn't easy for me to leave my gym or my coaches or my management, you know, but I want to keep on going forward.
So how many managers have reached out to you?
I want to work just with the best.
The best. So people. Thus far.
Just few of them. Just few of them. The best.
I feel like this is like, I don't know if you'll get the analogy, but like when there's like a supermodel at a club, no one goes up to her because they're intimidated, but she wants to talk to everyone, but no one goes up to her because they don't want to get shut down. I feel like everyone's kind of intimidated to come to you, but you're ready and willing to talk to people, right?
Yes, I'm ready to talk to them, but you know, I'm very thankful to my old manager, my coaches, for the job which we have done together, you know, what they did for me, because they're not gonna do this anymore. But the thing is, like, I'm different, you know. I'm the only UFC strawweight champion, and I'm going to be the flyweight champion as well.
The flyweight champion? Is that? I know you've talked about this.
125.
Well, I know, yeah, of course. 125. Have you gotten any more insight as to when they're going to introduce this?
No, I'm still waiting for that.
I think now you have the clout, like you have the influence that you could tell Dana White it's time to introduce this division, right? Do you think he would listen to you?
I'm kind of like calm person, you know. I don't like to ask for too much. Is it correct? I don't like to ask for lots of things, you know.
Sure.
So I like to do what I have to do, you know.
Do you think this time next year it happens?
It might be.
Wow. And by the way, I have to ask, the fact that your former managers are affiliated with Jessica Andrade, does that bother you at all, or did it bother you at all?
Say again.
You know Jessica Andrade, she's doing very well at 150.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
Did that bother you that they were?
I don't know. No, I can face Jessica. I can face any one of them. I don't mind, you know. I spoke to Thiago about that, you know, because I left him like a month ago or a few weeks ago. But we've been talking about what's going to happen if I'm going to face Jessica. And he's my and her manager. He was my and her manager at that time. So fight is a fight. We must take this serious.
Have you been impressed with her? She said after her win?
Yes, Jessica is a very strong fighter. Her boxing is on point. Her jiu-jitsu is very good. She's very strong. She dropped from 135, so she's strong for 115 division.
Yeah, she said that Gadelha exposed you. Did you see this?
Yeah, I saw that. Come on. Everyone is smart before the fight with me, but then they are not smart anymore, you know, during the fight or after the fight.
Right. Do you think she's next, though, after Karolina?
I don't know who's next. I will ask.
But for now, it's Karolina Kovalkiewicz. Do you have an official prediction how you're going to beat her?
I don't know. I feel that I'm going to be a different fighter than I was in the fight with Claudia Gadelha.
Oh, wow. Why so? New team?
I don't want to just win with Karolina, you know. I want to really, really put on show.
Because it's New York or because it's Karolina or both?
Because it's me.
Because it's you. Joanna, you're the best.
I like Karolina, you know. A lot of crazy things coming out. People in Poland, they want to, ask proof to who is the best in Poland, but I'm the best in the world. That's the thing, you know. I just want to be the best in the world.
Right. Do you feel like this is a big deal? I know you're not in Poland right now, but are you getting the sense that this is a very big deal over there?
It is. It's a very big deal. People wanted this fight to happen in Poland, but... I think that I'm international champion, you know. Of course, I want to fight in Poland. I want to fight there for my fans, my family, but maybe next year.
All right. Well, Joanna...
So Karolina should be happy that we're going to fight on 205.
That's right. And wow, what a scene it will be on November 12th. You know, by the way, last thing, did you get to go in MSG and look around and see the history over there?
Yes, I was there. It's an amazing place. Very, magical.
Magical. You must be excited.
Yes.
You must be very excited. Well, I'm happy that you're on the card because I know you wanted to be on the card so badly. I appreciate you coming on. I know it's very busy today for you. So thank you for some time and good luck on November 12th.
Thank you so much.
All right. Take care.
Bye-bye.
All right. Bye-bye. There she is. Joanna Jędrzejczyk, the UFC strawweight champion. What a scene it will be on November 12th. Three titles on the line. Hopefully the three title fight curse does not come into play because it has come into play. It has wreaked havoc on cards all over the place, but hopefully the gods leave 205 alone. Now, before we get to 205, it's 204. That's this Saturday. In my opinion, this is really, as far as real high-level important stuff, this is a two-fight card. And that's not slighting anyone else. There's some great stories. Mark Diakasi making his UFC debut. Stefan Struve's on the card. Mirsad Bektik was going to fight Arnold Allen. That's not happening, but still... he's always great. But the first two fights, I'm talking about the main event and the co-main event. So the top two fights are incredibly important and interesting. Bisping, Hendo for the middleweight title. And then it's a fight that, in my opinion, is 7 freaking years in the making, if not more. Vitor Belfort versus Gegard Mousasi. That's the co-main event. Are you kidding me? Gegard Mousasi joins us on the phone right now. Gegard, how are you?
I'm good, Dario. Thanks for having me.
Oh, thank you for the time before you go out. Are you in Manchester yet?
No, I'm leaving tomorrow afternoon.
Okay, so this is the big question for you, Gegard, because I was looking at an interview that we did. The first time I ever interviewed you was, believe it or not, at the Trump Tower in New York City. You were there for an Affliction event. You were fighting Babalu on the card, but the fight that you wanted and we all thought you were going to get was Vitor Belfort. And I feel like that's when this whole story between you and him kind of started. And you've said since then that he's not going to fight you. He'll never fight you. He's always going to find a reason. When you got the call that he had agreed to fight you and that it's finally going to happen, what was your reaction?
Well, he's not scared. I never first said he's scared. But the thing was, we were supposed to fight at the catchweight at Affliction. And because I wasn't coming down that much, I thought I couldn't come down that much. And later on, he declined and he went on fighting Rich Franklin for the same catch weight in UFC. But, it is what it is. At this stage, it makes sense for both of us. Before in the UFC, he was going for a title shot, so he was ahead of me. But now he's coming off a loss against Jacare, and I'm coming off 2 wins. But at this stage, it's a good fight for both of us.
you've been open in the past that you've tried to get the fight, that it didn't happen for whatever reason. Were you ever worried that it wouldn't come together, that something would happen where this fight that you've been wanting for quite some time would just not come to fruition?
Well, you know, you have always injuries, so I was worried about, you know, I, in the past, a lot of fights got canceled because of some injuries. But, you know, I wanted to have faced somebody with a big name, and I got that fight. Fido is a legend, you know, and everyone knows him in UFC, so it's a good fight for me.
How do you feel about the state of Vitor Belfort's career, like where he's at right now, given how he looked against Jacare, how he's looked in his last couple fights? Do you feel like he's as dangerous as always, or do you think that his skills are declining?
Well, he's dangerous because he goes for it, especially with his kicks, and he tries. He's, especially first couple minutes, he's dangerous. Against Whiteman, he was dangerous in the beginning. So you can never underestimate him, but I feel like I'm better. Stand up, ground, physical, age, you name it, I'm better. But you can always, if you're not careful, you can always walk into a punch or a kick. So
right.
Obviously we have to be careful of that. And besides that, guarantee is almost guaranteed, you know, victory, I mean.
Oh, victory, okay. You've been open in the past about PED use. He's had his history. Any concerns about fighting someone like him?
No, and I was just checked last week for urine and blood. And you know, it's almost impossible to cheat. You always can cheat, but the risk is so high that you get caught. So I'm not worried, and I'm ready. And it's a clean fight, and that's why I'm so confident I can beat him.
And just to kind of correct you, I mean, we have been seeing people cheat. Now there's always going to be a way. If you want to cheat, you can still kind of cheat, right? I mean, you've seen the news.
Well, yeah, but you get caught mostly.
Sure.
I mean, the guys, I would, you know, it's a very high risk that you, because they test you all the time. If your hormones are not out of balance, even if they don't catch you for, let's say, some kind of steroids, they can see that your hormones has changed, and they can figure out of that, you know. And it's difficult. I said the risk is high, so people that are going to risk it, they're not that smart.
Right. One of the interesting things about this card is that you are going to fight at around 4:30, if not maybe 5 a.m. local time. How do you feel about that?
Well, I sleep around 4 or 5 now. And once I'm there, I will go sleep even later. And so I can fight at that time. For me, it's not that difficult. You know, whatever I have to adjust, my opponent have to adjust. But I already sleep at 4 or 5. So all I have to do is this couple of days, sleep a little bit later, around 7, 8 o'clock in the morning maybe. But I don't know what time the weigh-ins are for Friday in the morning. So
right.
I have to figure out those things. And once I'm done with those, and I can do whatever I want.
Now, do you usually sleep at around that time, or did you adjust your clock because you were going to fight at that time?
Well, I sleep usually late, around 2, 3 o'clock in the morning anyway. And but now I'm getting a little bit, I try to sleep a little bit later every time. So it's not that difficult for me. I won't have any problems with the time fighting.
Okay. Obviously, the last time we saw you was at UFC 200. It seemed, at least to me, like you were in the running to get that Daniel Cormier fight. Was there ever a point where you thought you got it?
Well, at first, we got the fight. And we asked for the fight, and we got the fight. But later on, they got Anderson Silva. I don't know where they found him, and they gave him that fight. I heard he had the operation. He was on his couch. He showed up. He was not in shape. You could see he was below 200 pounds. But he got the fight because he just have the bigger name. It's simple as that.
Were you pissed off that you didn't get it?
100%. 100%. I knew I had a good chance of winning that fight. You know, why not? You know, nothing to lose. I would go for that fight. So, yeah, of course, you know. But what can we do? it was just the opportunity that we tried. At least that's what I can say.
The week was so crazy with John pulling out and then all this drama. Mentally, with you thinking that you got the fight, did that play any tricks on you where you had to get, you know, excited that you're going to fight Daniel Cormier, the champion, and then go back to fighting Thiago Santos? Was it a little confusing for you to deal with?
Yeah, definitely. We were very excited because that's what you work for, to fight for the belt. And circumstances were right to fight for the belt. So we were all happy. But other than that, and then, of course, after being very happy, we got very sad. So waste of time.
But then it didn't affect your performance, right? Did you maybe take out those frustrations on Thiago Santos? Because you look great in the fight.
Well, no, because I didn't look for the knockout. I knew his style. I knew I could close distance. And he just presented himself by standing up at the wrong way, let's say.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not looking. If it had gone three rounds, dominant, boring fight, it would have gone that way. But, you know, it depends on the opponent. Let's say Fedor comes and he tries to be explosive, he tries to bang, I cannot stay and let him do his thing. Then I have to be explosive. So it depends on the opponent, what kind of performance I put on, you know?
After watching the Anderson-Cormier fight, what were you thinking? Were you thinking, oh, man, if I was in there, I was going to win this fight?
Yeah, you never know if you're going to win that fight. But, you know, I don't feel like Daniel Cormier was at his best. And I felt like I would have 100% I would have had a great chance of winning.
Yeah. Well, by the way, when you were offered the fight, was it for the belt or would it have been a non-title?
I wanted to fight for the belt because for me it was not a problem 205 because
sure.
I weighed around 200 pounds. Anderson didn't want to fight for the belt because he knew he couldn't go five rounds. He wasn't in shape. So who deserved it more there? Me being in shape, able to go five rounds, or Anderson who just came and he knew go three rounds, just hold on, don't get knocked out. Who was the better fighter to fight that night?
Right.
Out of me or Anderson? It was me. But, you know, it is what it is.
But when you were offered the Cormier fight, was it for the belt?
Yeah, we wanted to fight for the belt. We wanted to go the five rounds.
Now, speaking of the belt, what's it like for you to be on this card with Dan Henderson fighting for the belt when not that long ago you beat Dan Henderson in rather quick fashion in Sweden?
For me, it doesn't mean anything. It's just a fight, but an important fight. You know, I was number nine. I was eight. Now I'm number nine again. I'm now fighting Fedor Belfort. He's number five, but everywhere in the I'm the favorite in the bookmakers. So how is that possible? Number five and number five, nine fighting number five guy, but I'm the favorite to win. So the ranking doesn't make sense. And then on Sherdog, they don't have even me in the top 10. You know,
really?
I don't know. Yeah, they don't even have me in the top 10. These guys are, I don't know what they're looking at. They're blind maybe or something.
Who do they have ahead of you? Wow. I need to see these rankings.
I don't know. They don't have me in the top 10 anyway. So.
Well, you're pissed off.
Well, not pissed off, but, you know, after beating him, Fedor Belfort, I'm curious what number they're going to make me then. But this one is important fight because after this I'm going to get a guy who's going to be maybe a contender, and then I can be a contender after the next one.
Have they told you?
Who gave, well, you know, the number one to four fighting each other.
Yeah.
The top, they all could fight for the belt. So two of them going to get eliminated. And then if I get a win, one of them will get a title shot. And the other winner, that guy I could face to be the next number one guy. So, but it's so far ahead of me. I'm not thinking about that. But first, need a win.
By the way, I'm looking at Sherdog right now. They actually have you at number 10, right there.
Yeah, maybe
it
last
changed.
Week or something.
Yeah.
But, yeah.
They have the likes of David Branch and Robert Whittaker ahead of you. And they have Vitor Belfort at number 7. Crazy stuff. Do you believe that Dan Henderson will retire if he wins the belt? Do you believe this?
Yeah, I think so. He's I don't know. Yeah, he said himself he's going to retire, so probably he's going to retire.
Who do you think wins that fight?
Well, Bisping has the better chances of winning, especially with his conditioning and being the more fit guy. He's more in shape. Dan Henderson has always that chance of that big overhead hand, but his timing is not there. So he has the power, but the timing should be also there. So you could say Dan, Michael Bisping has the better chance, but you never know. But it's 70-30 to Bisping, I would say.
It's so crazy when you think that Vitor, less than a year ago, knocked out Dan Henderson in 2 minutes. You remember that?
Yeah, yeah.
And he's getting the tail shot before both of you.
Well, you know, we know how it works. you know, maybe just try, I don't know.
There's a story there.
And you need to be the right guy from the right country, you know?
Sure. And have a history, and there's a story there with Michael. I know, I go on and on. Do you prefer fighting in Europe now as opposed to the U.S. now that you got this Vegas fight? What do you prefer?
Europe is always nice. I feel like I have home advantage. I'm fighting in my backyard, but still not the disadvantage fighting in your own country, you know?
Yeah.
Because, so always Europe is better for me.
Have you fought in, when's the last time you fought in the Netherlands, if ever?
Netherlands is a very long time ago. And, yeah. But since every fight in Europe I fought, I won. So I feel it gives you a little bit confident that this one will go well also. It's just, you know, a boost, a little bit boost, mental boost.
Wow, so you're undefeated in Europe?
Well, at least every time I fought for UFC in Europe, I won. So
okay, UFC.
I expect this one to go well also.
right, of course. So you say that you go out there tomorrow. You know what's going to be really interesting? If they make you do the media stuff at like the normal time, that might screw up with your sleep schedule. That's what I'm worried about.
No. I asked my manager about it, and they rescheduled everything. Everything is a little bit later in the afternoon. So they consider that we're fighting late, so...
Oh, that's nice.
Yeah, that's good.
It's going to be a crazy scene over there. Are you looking forward to it?
Yeah, I'm pumped up. I'm just waiting, doing interview, doing the media stuff, doing the...
That's your favorite.
Embedded and all that stuff, and just waiting for the fight.
By the way, did you ever find out the guy who stole that stuff from your house? Did you ever find those people?
No, that's a long time ago. And,
those bastards.
I don't think the police has better things to do than looking for those guys.
Well, quite frankly, I think that they should get on it. Because I remember in one of your embeddeds, you were driving around in a really nice car. Is that happening? Am I thinking of the right part? I think I am, right? Weren't you driving around in a really fancy car recently in one of the embeddeds?
Yeah, but that was not mine. But I got a new car.
Still, what'd you get? Yeah.
It's a 550D BMW. It's only for Europe market, I think, the diesel.
Oh.
It's not for Americans don't drive diesel, so it's not like that popular for them.
But that's a nice car. So life is good for Gegard Mousasi.
I like it.
But life is good, right?
Yeah, it's not bad. I don't come short on anything, so.
All right.
yeah.
I like it. Okay, do we have a prediction for Saturday?
First round, I believe.
Wow. First round. Do you think that this will be Vitor Belfort's last UFC fight if you end him in the first round?
No, I don't think so. I think he can still beat a lot of guys.
All right. Well, I'm looking forward to it. Do you remember that interview back in 2009 when we were talking in the Trump building?
Yeah, I got even a picture with Donald Trump. So.
Wow. That's isn't it amazing that he can now be the... You fought for maybe the next president of the United States.
Yeah, I think, I don't know, he was friendly to me, I don't know,
he was
a nice guy.
I should actually correct that, because that fight never actually happened. You never actually fought for Affliction, right?
No, eventually they caught Josh Barnett and the show got canceled.
That's right, because you weren't on the first or second show, you were going to be on the third, then it got canceled, yeah. But you got to meet Donald Trump. Do you have that photo?
Somewhere on my laptop, I believe, yeah.
Wow, that's amazing. So, if you do, you think would you vote for Trump because you met him, or is that not enough?
Well, I don't like Hillary.
Oh, so you don't?
I'm not American, but if I had the choice, I would go for Donald.
Wow, what a revelation! Yeah. This is huge stuff. Yeah. Do you mind me asking why?
Well, you know, I think Hillary is a bigger liar. She's a more professional liar.
Oh.
So I prefer the guy that lies, but you know he's lying.
That's right.
Than someone you know she's so good in lying that you don't know.
Have you been following this stuff a lot? Like, are you the kind of guy that watches all the...
I've been watching the debate. It's actually fun. You know, at least with Donald Trump, you're going to have a funny 4 years. Have some fun. Yeah.
I don't know if people would describe it as fun, but
I don't know. You know, it's not that good that those, you know, from all those people in the United States, those are the candidates.
It's crazy.
So I mean, like, you can find better guys, but you know, that's politics.
They must be making fun of the United States over there in the Netherlands, right?
Well, not fun, but it's like...
what is going
you
on?
You heard, you know, Donald say some stupid shit, and then you think that guy going to be president, and then Hillary with the scandals and lying. I don't know. It doesn't have a good image, let's say.
Yeah, amazing. Yeah. All right. Well, we'll leave it at that. Gegard, always a pleasure. I'm looking forward to it, and I'm happy that you finally got the fight that you wanted. This Saturday, Gegard Mousasi versus Vitor Belfort, UFC 204, co-main event, an important fight in the middleweight division. Looking forward to that very much. Gegard, appreciate the time. Safe travels, and good luck on Saturday.
Thank you, Ariel. Thank you.
Okay, we'll talk to you soon. Bye. There he is, Gegard Mousasi stopping by. Massive fight for him this Saturday at 204. Okay, let's move along. The top contender in the women's bantamweight division, don't get it twisted, the top active competitor right now at 135 for the women is the Venezuelan vixen, Juliana Pena. Who's she going to fight next? When's she going to fight next? These are all questions that we don't have answers to. So that is why we have invited her on the show today to try to answer some of them. And she's joining us right now. Always a pleasure to talk to Juliana. Are you there?
Yes, I'm here. How are you?
Oh, yes. A little pep in your step this morning. I like it.
A little bit, not much.
Okay. Well, thank you for having us, Juliana. Thank you for coming on, I should say. So, okay, where to begin? You come off that big win. Speaking of UFC 200, you defeat Katsingano, and, you know, you're talking about Amanda Nunes. We're thinking it's getting close. Then we see Shevchenko beat Holm, and then it gets interesting. You actually came on the show, and then a report comes out that they were targeting you versus Shevchenko for UFC 205 in New York. Is this true?
I have no idea. I've never been targeting Valentina. I'm not trying to go backwards. I'm trying to pick the fights that propel me forward. I want to fight for the belt, and I want the big fights. I want to fight the best girls in the world. I want to get excited for fights. I want to, you know, get up out of bed in the morning and think I am ready to freaking go hit the heavy bag or punch someone in the face and just picture Amanda's face on it or Ronda's face on it. If they're not saying, you know, come fight Amanda or come fight Ronda, then, I mean, it's nothing really interests me until that.
So did they come to you with Valentina and you're like, yeah, thanks, but no thanks?
No, something like that. It's just they didn't call me and tell me, hey, you're fighting Ronda or, hey, you're fighting Amanda. So I said, cool. Well, when you guys are ready for me to fight those two girls, you call me up and let me know. I'm ready. I'm ready to go. I'm ready to fight those girls. You know, the only fight that makes sense to me was me and Amanda both winning on UFC 200. The only logical thing and the only thing that I had in my head and that I was being told is that I'd be fighting for the title. And the biggest, hugest card in the whole world is coming up at Madison Square Garden. So that's the only place, time, and opponents that I was thinking about for that time frame. And so they didn't say that to me, or they haven't yet. I'm still waiting. I'm on idle waiting for them to change their mind. You know, I'm ready to go. I've been training, and I'm ready to fight one of those girls. If they need me to step in and fight at Madison Square against Amanda or Ronda, let's do it, because I'm more than ready.
To the best of your knowledge, is Ronda getting the next title fight? Like, do you think that that's actually going down and that's why they didn't give you Amanda?
I, I don't know. I heard she's never coming back ever. So I really don't know what's going on. But, I mean, if she were to come back, I guarantee you that the fight that she would only come back for would be probably Amanda.
Right. Do you think that's not fair to fighters like you who have been active in trying to climb the ladder?
Yeah, I think it's baloney. When Dana White announced that women were going to be fighting in the UFC, that was the same exact time that he announced that women would be fighting on The Ultimate Fighter for the first time. So I've been around from the very beginning. I've been around fighting these girls and grinding and taking this path of, not knowing who I'm going to fight as far as all the girls on The Ultimate Fighter, and then fighting everybody that they've been putting in front of me, inside the UFC octagon. So I'm the only girl that's consistently winning. And if this was a tournament format like it was on The Ultimate Fighter, I mean, I don't even know how some of these other girls are still in the tournament. They're still winning, and they're, 1-1-1 is their records, and then they're offering me to fight them when I'm, 7-0, and I've not been even beat up in a fight before. Like, some of these matchups, they just don't make any sense to me. And coming off of a not only a loss, but, a no-controversial loss, you got knocked the F out. You got knocked out, and then you get a title fight coming off of that. I'm still scratching my head trying to piece it together. It doesn't make sense. And it, like I said, if this was a tournament style format, I would be the only one left standing. And so to me, it's just kind of all nonsense. In the meantime, like I said, I'm ready to go. And when that phone rings and says, hey, you're fighting Ronda or you're fighting Amanda, I'll be like, perfect.
So right now it seems like they're targeting December 30th. That's what all the talk has been surrounding. As far as the date is concerned, Amanda versus Ronda. And so let's say that fight happens then, and we're only, early October, and then the person has to wait 3, 4, 5 months, the winner. Like, are you ready to and willing to sit out for that long?
I'm ready to fight the big fights. I'm ready to fight for the whole enchilada, all the marbles, the big yellow banana. I want it all. So I'm ready to go when that fight comes. And until then, maybe I'll get ants in the pants. But in the meantime, I'm just ready to fight the best girls in the world and ready to show the world why I'm the best fighter in the world.
Is it a little deflating to have now won 7 in a row? And I like the fact that you always bring up the other 3 fights on The Ultimate Fighter, because those are real fights. Like, it's crazy that those aren't considered real fights against real top fighters. I mean, you can make the case that in the recent history of The Ultimate Fighter, that was the toughest road to a title fight, just because those weren't, unknown fighters. Those were all ranked, very strong fighters. Anyhow, is it deflating that you go through that kind of run and you're still kind of left in limbo?
Yeah, it is, because girls that were on The Ultimate Fighter for the 115-pound division walk away with the belt, a 115-pound strap. Girls that were coaches on The Ultimate Fighter got to fight twice for the strap, there's girls that I beat on The Ultimate Fighter that other girls in the division didn't sign up to go on to The Ultimate Fighter. They could have gone on The Ultimate Fighter. They could have signed up for that tournament, but they didn't. I'm the only female that could have won that tournament at that time. And so for these girls to beat other girls that didn't get past me on The Ultimate Fighter, they go to split decisions with these girls, and then they get title shots. To me, it's just baffling. I don't understand it. I don't understand why these girls keep getting these hand-picked fights against JV competition. It makes no sense to me. And I don't know how much more I can make it clear that I am the only girl in the division that is unbeaten. I'm the only girl that's fought in a hell of a lot more people than anybody else has fought in and still not got a title shot. So it's like they want me to win 9-0 and then get a title shot, where the rest of these girls are 0-1 or 1-1 and 1-1-1 and still getting title shots. These records, they don't make sense to me. It's almost like a popularity contest, and clearly I'm not winning on that end. But I definitely know that I am the best fighter out there right now, and I definitely know that I'm a nightmare matchup for any of these girls. So if any of them want to prove themselves and test themselves against the best female fighter in the world, I'm right here and I'm waiting and I'm ready to go. If your name is Amanda Nunes or Ronda Rousey and you'd like to fight a girl named Juliana Pena, then sign up, because I'm right here.
And so you're in Chicago right now, right?
Yes, sir.
And you're training there, right? You're with your coach?
Yes, sir.
Is it hard?
Yes,
sir. Is it hard to get up? And where do you get the motivation when you're left in limbo?
Oh man, I get motivation all the time. I literally every day somebody sends me some inspirational video, or they'll, you know, tell me how much they believe in me. They'll write me poems. They'll send me flowers. You know, I have some of the best fans in the world that truly are dedicated to my journey and are dedicated to making sure that I get the title shot and that I'm fighting the best fights out there for myself. And those people are the ones that keep me going. Aside from that, God, I can't show you or tell you about a more dedicated fighter than me. You know, I've had my arm broken in a fight and I kept fighting and told them to put that arm back in for round three and let's go again. You know, I've been hit by a car and I went and fought again. I actually fought that fight that I got my arm broken in and I kept fighting. You know, I tore my knee out, 4 out of 5 ligaments, got hit and ran over by a car, was knocked out. And then, I kept fighting. You know, I've gone through so much adversity. I feel like I came back after tearing 4 out of 5 ligaments in my knee in a year and a couple months. That's unheard of. That's in no other professional sport, not football, not basketball, nothing. Have they been able to come back in that amount of time and still be competing at the highest level? I have a sheer determination inside of my heart and inside of my soul to be the best that I can be. And I don't want any time to go by and me sit there and say, oh, I coulda, woulda, shoulda. You know, I'm living out all those things that I want to do now. And now's my time. Now's my time to grind. And, you know, I want to get excited for big fights. I don't want to, you know, get excited for fights that are, I feel, insulting. And so I'm ready for the big guys. I'm ready for the big guns. I'm ready for the big shows. I'm ready for the big money fights. I'm ready for the title fight. I'm ready to fight the big names, and I'm ready to take what's mine. And I think that that determination myself is something that drives me, and it's not going to stop until I get what I want. I can promise you it is not going to stop until I get what I want.
And to be clear, you feel like the Valentina offer is insulting.
Yeah, who is that?
Is that a rhetorical question?
I don't know. Is that that girl that's 1-1-1?
Right.
Is that girl that keeps getting split decisions and has never finished a fly? What has she done in the division? I want to know. What exactly? I've done. You think about putting her up against Misha or Kat. You think she's going to escape those ones and get out of those fights alive? Like, forget about it. Who is this chick?
She told MMA Fighting last week, I agreed, I signed my part, but then we got information that Juliana Pena is trying to escape. She doesn't want to fight me.
I don't give a shit, Ariel. I really don't. She needs to fight me.
Right.
Of course.
Right.
Does nothing for me. Oh, you beat a girl and now you're still undefeated? Oh, okay, now you can get a title shot? You mean after beating her, then I'll be ready for a title shot? Like, give me a fucking break.
You have a pretty good relationship with Sean Shelby and Dana White. Did you express this to them? And if so, what do they say back?
Yeah, no, I have. It's getting to a point where it's like I don't want to offend or get, you know, too crazy, because the way that I feel, it's like I'm so hot that I don't want to appear any more psycho than I am, you know. And that's what's going to happen if I go get in their face and start, you know, popping off about how I really feel. So they know what I want. They know, you know, that I don't need to be popping off to be all crazy to get what I want. So I think we'll just have to wait and find out. And when Princess Spoiled Rhonda makes her moves, then I'll be at more liberty to say what's going to happen with me and what I'm going to do. But until then, I'm not jumping until she jumps.
Did you get any kind of sense that, like, they have a deadline that they need to know? Because it's already October. I mean, we're not at the deadline yet, but did they say, okay, let us see what's going on, Rhonda, and then we'll get back to you? Or did they give you a definitive...
You know, I don't talk about that. That's business that I leave to my management. I just train. I come to the gym. I show up, you know, 3 times a day, and I do my job in the gym and do everything on the mat. And that's all I need to be doing. I'll let, you know, the management side handle all that other fancy stuff.
Can I throw an idea out your way? If it's
yes,
not,
please, yeah.
Okay, I think we would agree that Ronda Rousey is the biggest fight in the division in terms of, like, name recognition and what can happen if you win and all that stuff, even though she's not the champ at this time. But you can make a very strong case that after Ronda, the next biggest women's fight out there is Chris Cyborg. Do you have any interest in fighting her?
I mean, if I'm the champion, yeah. Otherwise, it's just like, ugh.
Why is it like that?
I don't know. Why'd you laugh?
Well, just your reaction is a funny reaction. I mean, I've never gotten that answer.
Why are you laughing, Ariel? Why? You know what I'm talking about. You know what I'm talking about.
No, I mean, that is...
Don't get me started on that chick, okay? Please, don't get me started.
Okay, fair enough. I mean,
well, that's apples and oranges, okay? We're talking about the 135-pound women's bantamweight division, the division that I'm in.
Okay.
So
you're not interested in, like, a super fight, 140, something like that?
Like I said, when the strap's around my waist, yeah, I'll be able to hand-pick all my fights like the rest of those freaking cans do, and then I'll be able to figure out, you know, who I want to fight after that. And obviously, that would be a big, huge super fight. So, yeah, it will interest me when that time comes. In the meantime, I'm trying to focus on what's in front of me. And these girls, they don't want to fight me, and they don't want to give up their belt, and I don't blame them.
Yeah, do you feel like this is all just a bad case of bad luck in the sense that, like, the timing with Ronda, like, if you would have been, if 200 was a couple months earlier, you would have been the one fighting for the belt or something like that. But now with her impending return, that it's delaying your stuff? Or do you feel like there's a reason why they don't want to give you the title shot?
Well, I just feel that, like with the people that I've fought, and you know what I mean? Like, you beat Jessica Ai, you get a title shot. That's happened with Misha, you know? You beat Kat Zingano, you get a title shot. Misha couldn't beat her. So then Zingano fought Nunes and beat her, and then she got a title shot, you know what I mean? I beat Kat Zingano, I beat Jessica Ai, I beat, you know, girls like Shayna Baszler, who other girls have beaten Shayna Baszler, and they gotten title shots. I've beaten these girls, and they've all gotten title shots. I'm the only one that hasn't. So it baffles me, you know, it might be bad luck, it might be bad timing. I think it's always been the Ronda Rousey show, and everyone else is just, you know, subject to whatever she decides and wants to do. So she says she's coming back. We'll see about that. And when she does, thank God, I guess, you know, because obviously the fans want to see her and I want to fight her. But I can guarantee you when she does come back, she's not going to want anything to do with me. She hasn't wanted anything to do with me from the very beginning when she said that I didn't deserve to breathe the same air as another human being, you know. So this girl, I make her so uncomfortable. I remember in Australia, I was sitting in the room where they sign all the posters and do all the, you know, pre-fight check weigh-ins and stuff like that, right, when you arrive during fight week. And she saw me, she took one look at me, and she said she wanted to vacate the area as soon as possible so that she could do her signings and have them bring everything up into her hotel room and have them do all the check-ins and stuff inside her hotel room instead of her have to be downstairs and around, you know, people like me. So The girl has been avoiding me from day one. If she does come back, I guarantee you she's going to avoid me some more. She doesn't want to fight me.
Didn't you just have a dream about her recently?
You know, that's funny that you said that. I did have a dream about her, Ariel. Yeah, it was crazy. She showed up to my house with a bouquet of flowers and a balloon, a coffee mug, and an envelope. And I dropped the coffee mug. It shattered. I don't remember what it said. But she said, congratulations, I'll see you in Germany. And I remember she walked away, and I was like, hey, well, you came all this way. Let's go get a drink. And she said, no, I'll let you know, is what she told me. But I remember the balloons and the flowers got tied up in this tree that was in front of my parents' yard, and the envelope was in my hands as she was walking away. And right as I was, like, turning the envelope over to, like, open it to see what it said on the inside, I woke up.
Oh.
It's crazy.
What do you think it all means?
I don't know. Hopefully she knows how ridiculous it is that she's coming off of a knockout and gets a title shot right away. So maybe she's like, maybe I'll fight Juliana, who without a title, and give her that fight and then go fight. And then the winner, because she's being fair, will get the title shot after that.
What's a bigger deal to you, fighting Ronda next or fighting for the belt next?
I've been wanting to reintroduce Ronda back into the division for a very long time. I would love to fight Ronda Rousey for sure. That girl's been needing a beating and a beat down from me for since 2013, actually. So I would love that fight.
That's when the show was, right?
Yes, sir.
And I kind of feel like there was a lost opportunity when you guys were in Atlanta in the same van with Derek Lewis, you and Amanda Nunes. There was some magic there, right? I mean, that footage in its own right could get you the title fight, I feel like.
Oh, what do you want
want me to turn around and be like, hey, fight me, you dumb broad. You know what I mean? I would. I can get real ghetto. Trust me. I don't know. Like, she knows that I want to fight her. She herself has said several times that she would like to fight me when she knows Ronda's coming back or not coming back. The only question to me is nobody else waited for Ronda to come back and they put their belt on the line. So why are you, you know, if you think you're the best in the world, then, and you want to get a payday with Ronda, put your payday right here real quick with me and then go fight Ronda afterwards.
Right.
But she can't. She can't. She doesn't have enough confidence in herself to make that type of bet. She doesn't believe in herself as a fighter to put it all out on the line like that. I, on the other hand, am. I'm willing to put up all my title for the first ever female Ultimate Fighter. I'm willing to put up my undefeated record and be the only unbeaten girl in the UFC to be taking on these big, massive fights and putting it all on the line out there. Nobody else is willing to do that besides me. So, I mean, I don't really know what to say. I keep saying the same thing over and over, and I am the force to be reckoned with in this women's bantamweight division. And like I said, I'm not going to stop until I get what I want.
I'll tell you this much. No one cuts a promo like Juliana Pena in that division. I mean, you have no equal as far as that is concerned.
Well, I just am speaking pure facts.
No, I
know. Ariel, if you look up at the stats, if you look in the division with who the rest of these girls have fought in to get title shots, girls that I have beaten and not gotten title shots, you know, their paths have been so much more easier than my path has been. I have had the hardest path, and yet I'm still going in there, and I'm still fighting. I'm getting thrown on my head and fighting through adversity. I'm a real fighter, plain as day. I know how to fight, and I know that.
Did you
what
say,
these other girls are doing is a question. I don't know.
Did you say any of that to Amanda? Like, did you guys have any interaction in that van?
No, none, except that everyone else thought it was real awkward, and I was like, I'm fine. I don't know what you guys are talking about. Cool, I'm chill. Everyone else was on pins and needles, but I was chilling. Like, this is a nice Escalade.
Wow, and even after, like, you guys were literally together the whole, like, in that VIP area. I saw you there. She was with Nina, and Derek was kind of around you. Like, there was no run-ins, there was no incidents, there was no even interaction between you two?
No, she has, you know, her whole clan around her, like 30-something chicks or something like that. I don't know. I'm there by myself walking around like I own the place like I always do. So, I mean, if anyone was uncomfortable, it was them. It was not me.
Really? So the 30 were more uncomfortable than the lone wolf?
Oh, yeah. I'm a total lone wolf, and I always have been, and that's the way I prefer it.
Why?
I don't know. I don't like, you cannot trust too many people. You know, I'm a little paranoid in that aspect. I know who my friends are. I know who has my best interests and who's real and who's not. And, you know, I'm not interested in playing fakey little, ooh, I love you. I love you too, girl. Like, no, not about it. Not trying to do the whole fake thing. If I had, you know, if I wanted to be fake, maybe I could have, you know, been nicer or said something like, you know, something that I thought was true. But there was nothing like that. It's not like I thought her shoes were super cute or that her hair looked nice. So I'm not going to say anything like that. It's not like I thought that her fight career has been super impressive, because I don't think that's true either. You know,
right.
She looked good against Misha Tate one time. That was probably the only time I've ever seen her look good. So congratulations for that. I think I congratulated her when I was commentating for her fight and said, hey, yeah, good job. That was great. But I'd like to see her try to do that to me. And she doesn't want anything to do with that. She wants to wait for the big money fight. So we'll see how that goes.
And let's end on this. Speaking of commentating, you're commentating for Combate Americas. You're the color commentator, right?
Yes, sir. Thank you for acknowledging that.
Yes,
I'm going to be in New York City on the 11th.
The 11th, and Matt Hamill is headlining that card, so that's pretty cool. How did you get this job?
They asked for a fiery Latina that knows how to commentate for mixed martial arts, and I said, hey, that sounds right up my alley. Sign me right up. And I actually got the gig, and I've been doing it ever since. It's such a great promotion. Campbell McLaren is an amazing, extraordinary man. I'm working with some fine people over there at Combate Americas. And they also got a big title fight coming up. Gustavo Lopez versus John Sexy Mexi Castaneda.
Oh, yeah.
Fighting for the title. So it's their first title shot. And that's going to be awesome. I can't wait to commentate that fight. And like you said, UFC vet Matt Hamill, he's going to be on the card as well, headlining.
Now, were you someone that always wanted to do TV work, or did you just see this opening, do it, and now have fallen in love with it?
Yeah, you know, my sister, Grace Pena, she's always been like an amazing role model to me. She was the weather girl. She now works for Microsoft over in Seattle. And she was doing, you know, Xbox work. She was, you know, the little girl that pops up on Xbox Live that says, hey, this is the new game coming out and, you know, buy this game. But before that, she was doing the weather. So she's kind of been, you know, my role model as far as the entertainment aspect side goes to this thing. And she's always been very encouraging for me. You know, when your fighting career is over, you're going to have to put your foot in the door as far as other avenues go in the industry. And God, I got the gift of gab. I swear to God, I could talk forever and ever and ever and ever. And I think that talking about mixed martial arts and commentating these fights is something that I'm super passionate about. It almost comes so naturally and easily to me that it's fun. I would do it for free. I would do it in general. You know, it's just something that I'm very passionate about and love to do. And so it's definitely something that I'm interested in doing in the future, along with fighting. Absolutely.
Well, I think you do a great job, and I'm looking forward to your call. That is October 14th, right, at the Turning Stone Casino in Verona.
Yes.
I've been to the Turning Stone. Have you been to the Turning Stone before?
No, I've only been to that the center part,
Madison
downtown
Square.
In the center.
Okay. Well, this isn't exactly New York City.
Times Square. The only place I've been to is Times Square.
Right. This is outside of New York City, but I mean, it's in New York State, which I think is significant enough. And it's on UFC Fight Pass, by the way.
Yes, the Empire Rising.
Yes,
Empire Rising. It's going to be the show to watch.
All right. Well, I look forward to that. Great stuff, Juliana. I appreciate you you coming on and giving your side of things and making your case once again. And I hope it all works out for you. I sincerely do.
Thank you so much, Ariel. I really appreciate your time, and you guys just keep looking out for me and catch me on Fight Pass on October 14th for Combate, and watch that show because it's going to be amazing.
All right, good luck to you. Thank you.
Thank you.
There she is, the Venezuelan vixen herself, Juliana Pena. She is a very good commentator. Check it out on UFC Fight Pass on October 14th, Combate Americas. Okay, so how about this? How about this tie-in? So she was just talking about Campbell McLaren, one of the founders of the UFC back in the day. Campbell McLaren now works for Combate. You've heard him on this show not that long ago. Campbell McLaren was in the news a couple of weeks ago because he was in Japan for the Ryzen event, and he was seen on camera. In fact, it was the Combate Americas Twitter account that captured a little run-in in the lobby of the hotel over there in Japan between old friends Wanderlei Silva and felony Charles Bennett. Charles Bennett was fighting on the card. They've had a history dating back a decade in Pride, a little incident backstage. If you're a longtime fan of the sport, you know all about this. And then it was rekindled. Very much like how, you know, Ryzen is trying to tap into this Pride nostalgia. Boom, there it was. And then a couple days later at the Ryzen event, Charles Bennett goes out and KOs Minoru Kimura in 7 seconds. And perhaps even more impressive than the KO was his celebration. Everyone's been asking us to have Charles Bennett on the show. We have delivered. He is joining us via the magic of Skype right there. There he is, Charles Bennett, drinking a Mountain Dew. How are you, sir?
Pretty good, Ariel. How about yourself, man?
I'm doing great. Thanks for joining us, and thank you for coming on the show for the first time. Long time coming. I've been wanting to have you on the show for a while.
Yeah? Well, then that's wonderful, Ariel. I'm glad I seen it at UFC 200 and was begging you to have me on the show.
Well, I don't know about begging.
That's before I was nobody.
I think
I'm somebody now.
Oh, yeah. I think that was actually UFC 196. You were there with the Diaz brothers, right?
Yes, that is correct.
What are we smoking today?
Something of everything. Crack, crystal meth, heroin, a little bit of everything.
Okay.
Since that's what everyone thinks I'm on, I'm on a little bit of everything.
Do you feel, Charles, like you're one of the most misunderstood?
Can I have it, sir?
Yes, I do. Before you finish that, fuck yeah, Ariel. Chair. Yeah, a chair or something. Now I need that back support, bro. Yeah, back. I'm doing a lot of hunching.
Where are you right now?
I'm at my brother's AJ Hyde beauty salon.
Oh.
It's called High. Let me see if I can turn the camera around so you guys can check a look. All this new.
Yeah, plug him.
There he is.
Plug him.
Oh.
Let me plug him.
There he is.
Oh, yeah. Look at that.
Oh.
AK Thailand. What's up, man?
Yeah. Mark. So what's up,
Mike,
man?
Mike, Mitch VK.
Yeah, but this is where I'm at. I'm at his shop because I don't have Wi-Fi. I'm a broke-ass nigga, so therefore, I got to come to this nigga's shop, steal his Wi-Fi, and haul ass like a thief in the night.
Okay. Now go closer to the Wi-Fi so that it doesn't get all pixelated.
Oh, yeah, yeah. I'm not going to fuck your shit up, Ariel. Hell no.
All right.
We're going to be on together, bro.
Okay, so go back to my question there about being misunderstood. You feel like you are.
Seen the pain?
Do I feel? Yeah. How do I feel that I'm misunderstood? Because, like, everyone out here in the sport thinks I'm crazy, right?
Right.
So what I do in the cage or in the ring, he's crazy. But, motherfucker, I want to be an actor. I want to be a comedy actor, so... The more I get on camera, the more I can act, the more I can show that I have that skill and that talent to be an actor. Like, what's up? Somebody hit a nigga up because I really want to be an actor.
Okay.
So when I get out there, I try to act out. You know what I'm saying?
Oh, I see.
And if you look at the Vanderlei fight, because it was nothing to that guy, Phillip. Mm-mm.
Which guy, Phillip?
Because if you notice.
Yeah.
The guy that was standing in front of me that I was looking beyond.
Oh, wait. Are we talking about the one a couple weeks ago or the one 10 years ago?
Yeah. The one a couple weeks ago.
Okay.
That's the Vanderlei. It's the Vanderlei fight. You know why it's the Vanderlei fight? I'll tell you why. It's the Candylei. I'm sorry, Candy. My bad. I got your name fucked up. The Candylei fight.
Right.
You know why it's the Candylei fight? Because Candylei wanted to come out there and get in this guy's corner like it was going to discourage me. But if you notice the whole time when guy entered the ring and everything, like, dude, you're already beat. The guy behind you is where the money is.
Right.
So I'm not even looking at this guy. Like, when the ref put us to the ring, had us talking. Yeah, I gotta plug the shirt in. Everyone's crying about the felony t-shirt.
Yeah.
But ain't nobody hit my PayPal up yet. So y'all know y'all hit my PayPal up. Y'all study talking about these felony t-shirts, hit my PayPal up. So we can get you all these shirts.
Okay.
That's how that goes. But yeah.
There's a lot to unpack here. Let me ask you, why is your new, you're no longer Crazy Horse, right? You're Felony now, right? Why is that? Why did you make the change?
Because everyone frowns upon a felony. Everyone.
Right.
But I look at it like this, Ariel. Why can't felony be a good thing? Why can't I go out and speak to kids in my neighborhood and tell them, hey, these fighters don't want to catch a felony because I can probably end them in 7 seconds. And as a kid, you really don't want to catch a felony because it'll ruin your life. It ruins people's lives. Felonies ruin people's lives. So you don't want to get in any trouble due to the circumstances. Man, you don't want your life ruined.
Sure.
And, I mean, it's a hard road to come, Ariel, when you messed up your life in the beginning and then you're trying to correct it. And the world doesn't forgive. God forgives, but the world doesn't. So no matter how much good you do in this world, it's just not good enough. And then, hey, I still ain't been able to go talk to these kids in my community.
How come?
Because I have something to say, Ariel. I don't know. Maybe I don't have... See, it's just me, Ariel. It's not like, you know, when I got in that shit with the Brazilians, see how they come out as a fucking... come out as a group. When I step out, nigga, I'm a loner. I don't have a team. You know what I'm saying? Like you know how long I'm. You know how many times I trained for this past fight.
How many times?
I knew about this fight, Waylon. I want to say like April or May. And I probably went to the gym about 1, 2, maybe 3 times. So. When people say hard work pays off, I say I'm blessed to not be stressed. And if you want to take this fight as serious as you can, go ahead and take it. But every day that I live to get ready to go fight, I'm not going to kill myself in the gym. No.
I'm not going to kill myself trying to get to the gym. Nope. If I feel I'm gifted enough that I don't need a trainer, I can train myself. I go run and play basketball all day, every day. Mm. And then I'll come in a fight and have, like, you can't even train for a guy like me. How do you train for a guy like me? You don't even know what's going to happen. That's just like fucking Candy Lay. He comes in there. I don't know what he was thinking. He was galloping across the ring. Why was he galloping across the ring? I don't understand it, you know? And I was reading the body language, like, what is he? Oh, so you don't want to see what each other, you know, you don't want to feel each other out. You just want to come and attack me? No, you don't just come and attack me. We're going to sit and feel each other out. And if we can't come to an agreement, then we'll slam you. The dude just wanted to come out there and catch me with something out of the ordinary. I don't know.
Felony is an
area. Go ahead.
Felony is an acronym, right?
Yes.
What does it stand for?
You ready?
Yes.
Fuck everybody left offended next year. Spells felony.
Why next year?
I say this because, why next year? Because shit, it's going to take a lot of work this year. Okay. Feel me? I gotta get it to where people are liking me, and then people are hating me, and then the people that really hate me, I want them to continue to hate me, but just a little piece of them, they gotta like me. Like Candy Lay, no matter how much he hates me, you can hate me all you want, but the more I watch that fight and look and see that smile on your face, dude, you really just putting on. You know what happened. I know what happened. We know what happened. And all those little homies that you had in that room that day know what happened. I'm just waiting for you to beef with one of them so they can come out and be like, yeah, the little guy knocked him out. I seen it. Oh, why you want to come out and tell it now? Because he's a piece of shit. And I feel the world needs to know.
So there's that footage of that locker room incident around 11 years ago, backstage at Pride. You get into this sort of scuffle with Cristiano Marcelo. He chokes you, and then they wake you up, and then nothing happens. You're saying that when they woke you up, you stood up and knocked out Vanderlei Silva, right?
Mm-hmm.
And they cut that out.
I did indeed. Ari, you know I could tell this story. You know the difference between a truth and a lie? 10 years ago, I probably couldn't tell you the same story as I could tell you today if it was a lie.
Right.
But considering that it's the truth, this story will play over and over, and I'll say it over and over. And people might not realize that, but it's the truth, man. No matter how much you lie, you're going to eventually come tell that story again, and you're going to have to tell it the same lie. But 9 times out of 10, the lie won't be the same. But if you ask me that story again, like, nigga, hell, I was shocked I knocked this nigga out. Like, I'm surrounded by probably 8 or 9 Brazilians at the time. Everyone is looking at this guy, including myself. So I got a 5-second window to say, oh, shit, nigga, they're going to kill you if you continue to hang out around this motherfucker. But guess what I do? I shoot to the door, and I realize, like, damn, everybody was shocked in there. Everybody, Ariel. But they realized that that nigga was running. It was too late. I was at the door. So I probably, you know, got hit 1 or 2 times before I got drug out of the room. But I was laying down in the hallway laughing. I just knocked Vanderlei out. And then he come out, he's like, oh, you motherfucker, don't get it. And I got up and started running like, haha, it doesn't matter what you say now. I don't care how big you are, nigga. You're not going to catch me. Shit. Well,
and what's the crux
I'm gonna
of this
enjoy
issue?
That night.
What's the issue here between you two?
Good question, Harry. I don't have an issue.
Okay.
You know, when I seen Candy Lay that night, you know what I'm saying? I came in the room, was like, hey, what's up? Can I get a picture? He seen me, he was like, yeah. So as I'm walking up on him, nigga realized like, oh shit, that's that little nigga, that little guy that knocked me out a few years back. Hey, fuck you. And then he started waving his dick at me. So I'm like, okay, well, all right, that's cool. I see you still salty, nigga, but
oh, this is
I don't have
ago.
A beef.
This is 2 weeks ago.
Yeah, this.
You asked him for a picture.
Yeah.
Did you think that he would react that way?
In the beginning, he was like, yeah, come on in and get the picture. So as I'm walking in, the nigga noticed who I was and was like, fuck you. Fuck you. Went to waving his dick at him. Oh, fuck you. Fuck you. And I was like, oh, I put my hands up like, oh, okay. With my, you know, because I had my phone in my other hand. So I'm like, oh, okay. And I walked through, you know what I'm saying? Then he was talking shit. Hey, blah, 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 blah. And I was just like, picture, picture. You know what I'm saying? Let me get a picture, nigga. So he started talking shit. So then that's when I pull out my camera. I was like, okay, let's go live. Let's go live, you know? So I go on live and shit. And then the bitch spit on me. So when he spit on me, that's when I put my phone up. It's like, okay, yeah. Because if it gets any, you know what I'm saying, to that point. And like I say, man, these guys sit up here, these fucking keyboard junkies and Facebook honkies and punk-ass niggas. Oh, he was scared. He was scared. Like, nigga, who was scared? I can tell you who was scared. Candlelight was scared. And you know how he was scared? Because I'm going to tell you the difference between me and Candlelight. Okay, if a nigga knocks me out, I'll accept that. You know what I'm saying? Like, oh, fuck it. You know, carry on. But if a nigga spreading a rumor, then I have to do something to him. You know what I'm saying? Like, nigga, you're lying, so I got to do something to you. You rolled up, bro? Oh, okay. I rolled up, too.
What's that?
You didn't hear that, did you?
No, no, no.
Okay. You didn't hear it. Good. But, yeah, so the nigga fucking sitting up there like, damn, what was I going? Oh, yeah, so to me, you know what I'm saying? Like, because, yeah, you know, hey, I smoke that, and then, you know, I fight. So, nigga, yeah, sometimes I'll be forgetting shit. Like, I'll be driving and be like, where the fuck was I going? For real, like, oh, man. But, yeah, so fucking Candlelight sees me, and instead of attacking, because I'm lying on him, he approached with caution. You approach with caution, nigga. You know why you approach with caution? Because you know, in your little mind, in that little peanut head of yours, they got all the steroids in it, which then shook your brain, nigga. With that being said, felony, cremated that ass, and if anything that I was saying was a lie, then, nigga, as soon as you see me, because you're so much bigger, you'd attack. You came in full force, fuck that nigga. You ain't knocked me out, nigga. So I'm gonna come in at your ass. 100. No, what you did was you stood back, you talk shit to me. Not only did you talk shit to me, but you sat there and you fucking spit on me. You spit on me.
Someone calling you?
You know, I feel
calling you.
Yeah. No, they're calling me on another phone.
Oh, okay.
But she's all right. Yeah, but
did you have another run in with him?
Yeah, so. Huh?
Did you see him the rest of the week in Japan, or was that the only time that you saw him? Like,
yeah, okay. Yeah, at the first time I seen him was at the fucking whatchamacallit, the hotel when I came in that lobby.
Yeah.
And all that shit went on.
Yeah.
That was the first time I seen him.
Okay.
So that's what I'm saying. Like, you would have did something. You know what I'm saying? Like,
sure.
if a nigga was so bad, you'd have did some shit then. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Hello. Hey. You're gonna be a part of this interview that I'm doing. All right. Oh. So you got. Yeah. I'm just telling you, you're gonna be, cause you're in jail, and I wanted to answer this call, so you're gonna be a part of this interview. All right. So say hello to Ariel. Hold on. Say hello, Ariel Hawani. I hope I said that right.
Yeah. Hello.
Hello?
Hello?
Yeah, say hello to Ariel.
Hello, how are you?
Say hello to...
Yeah, Ariel.
Oh, well, that's because I got the earphone.
Oh, yeah. How are you? Who's this?
Hello? Oh, yeah, you can't hear the nigga? He just say hello. Who is this? I don't know if you heard you, though.
Who is that?
Hey, what? This is Jasmine.
Hello, Jasmine.
Jasmine is a gangster.
Okay.
Jasmine went to jail for killing, we're trying to kill 3 guys and a baby.
Don't
say. All right, I'm playing. hey, Aaron, you thought I was telling the truth, huh? Damn, you're fucking so fucking gangsters out. And she's a girl?
Damn.
Yeah, but what I was saying though, Ariel, like on the real though, man, like seriously.
Hold on, Ma.
On the real though, Ariel, like if I would have seen someone like that, you know what I'm saying? Like I would have attacked off the ripper, like nigga. But the thing of it is, you're not gonna attack off the rip because you already know in your mind that you've been knocked out by this guy. So why go in full fledged like you told your son or your student or your sensei or whatever you want to call it, that now I hold a record over there because you told him to attack Toro.
So then he says that he wants to corner Kimura against you. So there's something. Did you guys have any other run-ins in the arena, hotel, any other interaction?
After the fight, right? You know me, after the celebration, because it really was not a fight.
Yeah, yeah.
So after the celebration.
And what a celebration it was, right?
Yeah, man. You know, I set it off in this motherfucker.
Right.
That's what I did.
Yeah.
Let's get the share. Because I need the money.
Sure.
I got four kids and a wife. I'm just playing.
And a wife.
I'm just playing. Yeah, she on the phone. Say hello, Jasmine.
Hello.
Hello, Jasmine. How are you?
You waving like she can see you. She's in jail. It's a jail's call, nigga. He waving like, hi, Jasmine. How are you? Hey, but yeah, so... I live a pretty interesting life, Ariel.
Sure.
You know what? The whole time I was in prison,
yeah,
I wrote in a journal. I wrote in the journal every day I was in prison because I really felt like I shouldn't have been in prison. Like,
when were you
in prison? My family sent me to prison. Oh, shit. I was in prison...
2013? 12?
13, 14, and 15.
And why they send you to prison?
Oh, man. That's another story, Ariel. I'm going to sell that story, though.
Okay.
I want money off that story. Only because I went to prison for some bullshit, man. My family sent me to prison. And then when they do that, it's like, I don't know, because all my life I've been the black sheep, you know what I'm saying? Like,
your phone's about to come off. I'll call you after medication.
All right, Ma. All
right?
Yeah. Get that crazy medicine.
What is that?
Yeah, so
is she really in jail?
Yeah, nigga. it's really in jail. Hey, I'm gonna send you a text message. I want you to write her and tell her thank you for coming on my show since this is an awesome show. That's all you gotta say is thank you for saying hi.
All right.
I know you're a dual area because you're a punk bitch.
What?
But I like you. I'm just kidding, man. I got a kiss. Hell, Ariel. I remember you in fucking, what is that nigga name? Rampage. I'm glad you guys fucking kissed and made up, man.
Yeah, yeah,
you
yeah.
Always been my homie, though. Ariel, you always been my homie, though, Ariel. Even with that little UFC scandal. Why won't the UFC have me, Ariel, huh? They say I can't be controlled. Is that what it is?
I don't know. Did they say that to you?
I don't know.
What about Bellator?
They were saying something about it, though.
Well, Ryzen seems to be treating you well.
They are. So I'm not even worried about those other organizations. Fuck them.
Now, why don't they...
I love going to...
Why don't they do you versus Vanderlei in Ryzen? Isn't that the fight that everyone wants to see? Open weight.
Yeah. I know, man, but I'm just a fighter. That's all I do. I don't get paid to do no thinking. And I don't get paid to do no thinking. I just fight.
You don't have a manager.
Hey, yeah. No, I have a homie. His name is Terry Troublecock. Fucks with that nigga. He's like my big brother.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, so if you guys don't know who Terry Troublecock is, he's a KOTC owner,
yep.
Which is King of the Cage.
Yep.
King of the Cage owner. And I fucks with my nigga hard. Like, yeah, that's my nigga. My next kid, I'm going to name after him.
Okay. Why? Is your significant other pregnant?
Hell no, nigga. I ain't got no girlfriend.
Okay.
Shit. I live alone. If I would have had Wi-Fi to my house, we would have did it with at my house.
Right.
But Eric was like, Charles, can you go somewhere where, you know, he didn't want to say Wi-Fi because he didn't want to.
No, you
know
that's not true. I asked, feel all you. Bad. I asked you if you had Skype. You said yes. I just want to see your face.
Yeah, I got Skype, nigga.
All right.
Oh, shit. What it is, isn't it?
Yeah.
My friend, it's fucking gorgeous over here.
Yeah, but
I mean, of course it is. You know, I didn't take any. The only hurt I had was flipping off the cage. My heart started pounding fast, and then running and flipping off the other rope. That's the only damage I took in the fight.
It must have been good to go back to Japan, right? They love you over there.
Yeah, it was. Oh shit, man, Aaron, you won't believe this shit, what? Nigga. Look at that. Look at that, Aaron.
What do we got?
Who that is, nigga?
Oh yeah, look at that. We're on TV. Oh. That's a first.
Yeah.
Are they playing my show at the hair salon? No one cares to hear your. To hear my show at the hair.
Yeah, at the. Yeah, they are playing your show at the hair salon, and there's some beautiful women in here. And considering that you are of the white descendant,
yeah.
Hey, you're number one pickings right now.
I'm a what?
They might be a number one picking.
Oh, okay, that's cool.
They might be 20 or 30 years older than you, but. I'm sure they can find some places to put you.
So wait, let me get back to Ryzen. Did you ask them to make the Vanderlei fight? Because I feel like this is the fight that you want.
Yeah, it is most definitely the fight that I want. You know what I'm saying? After the fight, I go and I'm on Facebook and...
The Skype is going a little wonky now. The Wi-Fi is going a little... it's getting a little... Let's see.
Is that better? I moved back over in front of the TV. You did. Why you keep throwing the phones up, nigga?
Who, me?
Oh, yeah. Oh.
It's delayed.
Yeah, I guess we're on a delay line. Hey, so with that being said, it's not a chapter in my book because a lot of people know that what I said is true. Like, I don't have no reason to lie to this guy.
Sure.
Lie about it. You know what I'm saying? Like, what am I getting out of it? What am I getting out of saying, oh, I knocked Vanderlei out? You know what I'm saying? I didn't make any money off of that. So what am I getting out of? Publicity? Man, I don't want the attention. When I got back in town, you know what I did? I went home.
Mm.
Sat in my house, hit like a little wanted little animal. Because I didn't, you know what I'm saying? Like,
well, because it was kind of cool, because all of a sudden you sort of disappeared for a while, and now you've emerged, and you were the talk of the town like a week or so ago. Everyone was talking about you.
Yeah, and that's the thing. Like, I've had six fights since I've been out.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? I've had six fights since I've been out, and with all six of these fights, oh, this is the shit right here.
What is that?
This is a... Whatever you wanted to be, dog.
Stay right there. Stay right there. The connection is good now.
Shit. Damn, nigga.
Are you okay?
Strong. I'm good, though, man.
When's your next fight? Do you have your next fight yet?
December.
Oh.
December 30th, back in Rising.
Oh, against who?
Back in Japan.
Against who?
Huh?
Against who?
I don't know yet.
Okay.
But, like I said, I've been on fucking the internet and shit. And
yeah.
The next day I got back in the States. God damn. I can't even enjoy this shit, nigga. It's so strong. I just love you. Hey, but yeah. Bro, here you go. What the fuck?
It's very potent, isn't it?
Nigga sweating.
Yeah.
Yeah, look at all this. God damn, nigga.
You're sweating more. You're sweating more right now than you were in the actual fight.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, but, Ari, what was he talking about, bro?
Your next fight, December 30th, who's it against? It's not Vanderlei, right?
Yeah. But see, I was on fucking Facebook,
yeah.
And I can't read Portuguese. I can't read it.
Sure.
So and I don't understand it neither. So I'm sitting up there and I watch old Candelay talk for about 3 minutes, and I was like, man, fuck this shit. I don't know what this nigga's saying. So let me just go read the comments, cause yeah, I can read
I can read and write the English language. Yes, I can do that. So, because you guys think I'm crazy, I'm far from it. You guys are fucking crazy. So I go read the comments, and it's, Candelay, are you begging Jose to come fight Felony?
Ah.
Pretty much that's what I'm getting. He's like, Jose, you should come to Japan and fight. And everyone is talking about money. Like, nigga, Vanderlei want to fight me so bad, right? He don't care where it is. It could be in the street. It can be in an arena. It can be in hell. He wants to fight. Vanderlei, Candelay, there's no fighting Candy, because if you ain't got that money, we ain't fighting. I'm gonna walk away every day with the fact that I know I knocked you out. And you're gonna walk away with the same fact that you know that little nigga knocked you out. So with that being said, we both know, and like I said, the million people that was in that locker room, you know what I mean? They know. Like, who's gotta lie about some shit like that? All right, you seen that I got choked out. And you know what? The tape is so cut and edited. It's just like in life, you know what I mean? Like, nigga, you make me seem like the aggressor. When you look at the tape, the tape starts from when I lunged that dude. Like, it just instantly cuts to lunging that dude. Like, dude hit me twice before I even attempted to. I was sitting down. So he walked back up on me. And as I get ready to stand up, he throw two punches. Boom, boom, boom. And then how you do, sir? Then I lunge at him. And then that's where you see all that shit go. And then next thing you know, the tape cut again. And I'm being choked to sleep. And then next thing you know, the tape cuts off. But when the tape cut off, I was upset that Candelay was kicking me. What Candelay was kicking me for? You know what I'm saying? You're the bigger fighter. You're the most oldest fighter. You should be the more mature fighter. Not only that, you should give me the respect that I feel like I deserved, considering that nigga was 10 of y'all and one of me. And that's how it always is. I was really surprised to see this nigga in Japan 2 weeks ago with just him. Hmm. Like, wow, where's your crew, you faggot?
Did you not have a corner? Did you not have a corner for that fight? Were you alone?
No, I had a corner. For which fight? The last?
Yeah,
last
Kimura.
I had three corner men for that fight.
Go ahead.
Because he was a... It was James Lee, Eddie DeLuca, and Terry Troublecock in my corner.
Okay.
They're all in the ring with me.
Are you going to keep training with the Diaz brothers? Because I saw you hanging with them prior to the first Conor fight.
You know, I fucking love those guys. You know what I'm saying? But fucking Nick tried me, yo.
What do you mean?
Tried me. So I feel... Well, I came out to Vegas one time, the second time, to train with Nick now for my fight that I had coming up. Well, it can't come to the understanding that that's what they wasn't training at. But yeah, I'm calling Nick. He's not answering my phone. I can understand the nigga, you know what I'm saying? That's how that nigga do, you know what I mean? But damn, nigga, I'm in Vegas, and I just told you I was in Vegas, and you still not answer my call. So I'm like, I had to sit to the airport and wait. Then I got a ride to some people house, which is Isaiah Lorenzo and his girlfriend, Nicole Northwood, something like that.
Okay.
But yeah, so I went and stayed at their house until the next day. Then the next day I get up and I go to the hotel. I get a ride to the hotel and shit. I get to the ride to the hotel. I'm steady calling Nick on the way there. He's not picking up. He's not picking up. He's not picking up. So when I get to the hotel, Nick's at the front desk. I'm like, damn, bro, what's up, bro? I know you seen calling this and that. So, I talked to him briefly, but at the same time, it was like, I don't know what they had going on at the desk. So, when they get through at the desk, we go up to the room. I go use the bathroom. I come out. Nick gone. So I'm like, damn, where Nick at? Then his homeboy that's in the room, I see him packing up and shit. So, he packing up his shit. Then he's getting ready to leave. Then I see two girls in there, and they're looking at me crazy. So, I'm thinking, damn, what the fuck? I read people. I'm a people's person, so I read people. When I say I'm a people's person, people like me. When they first meet me, it's like, damn, this guy, and I don't care who you can be, a complete stranger. I can walk up onto you and have a
decent conversation, and you're gonna like me. So with that being said, it's like, damn, what the fuck these girls looking at me crazy for? So they leave out the room, and then the dude in the room. So I'm like, he like, well, I'm finna go down to the car, put my stuff in the car, and I'll be back up. I was like, see, I'm finna walk with you, because I already see, like, something fishy right here, you know? So I'm going to walk with him. But then he was like, ah, well, Nick's got the key to the room, and if you leave the room, you're going to leave your stuff in there. Cause like I said, I had just flew out to Japan, I mean, to Vegas, to train with these niggas. So I'm in the room for about 2 hours, then fell asleep a little bit. I wake up and the phone's ringing. So I answer the phone and the lady was like, yes, this is Diaz Brothers, Nick or Nate. I was like, yeah. She was like, well, yeah, we have your room and yeah, we didn't get the reservation in time. So you're going to have to check out the room. Are all your stuff packed? And I was like, I looked around the room like, yep. These motherfuckers, I ain't been answering my calls, nothing. Okay. I said, yeah, everything's packed, man. So I did my thug-tism because I felt like I was disrespected. So I felt the best way to disrespect him back. I'm not going to tell you what I did because then they might try to come looking for me. And I'm not talking about the Diaz brothers, neither. I'm talking about that law, nigga. I don't want any part of the law, nigga.
I hear you.
So, yeah, I fucking, but you know what I did get?
What?
It's to my house right now. It's a 209. It's a hashtag 209 free Nick. Yeah, I don't even use those shits.
I feel you.
You feel me?
Well, we have.
You probably don't feel me. But...
No, I do feel. Charles, we have run out of time. We've gone extra. We've gone overtime here.
That's cool.
Do you feel like you got everything off your chest? You feel good about it?
Except for, I love them Diaz brothers, though, man. I fuck with them niggas hard. You know what I'm saying? Like, I look at, I do a lot of research on those guys. And, man, those, I think I live worse than those guys, but those guys they're right on that totem pole with me. So that's why I got so much respect for them. Like, I got number love for those guys. Cause I know, man, living, when you're living the hard life, nigga, growing up as a kid, you can't help but fight so good in life. Like, you got to look at that shit and think like, man, I'm here for a reason.
Right.
And that's how I look like. These people, like, they don't want to do shit for me. You know what I'm saying? The UFC doesn't want me because of my domestics and all this shit. You know what I'm saying? Like, nigga, hey, I would be the best spokesman for those guys that want to put hands on women. I'm the best guy to talk to. You know why? Because it's pointless. What are you going to beat up a girl for? Unless she's putting her hands on you. If she's hurting you by putting her hands on you, then, yeah, I mean, you don't have to go to the scream to, you know what I'm saying? But, yeah, you can... But for just going and jumping on these women because they fucking this dude or they lying about something, like, it's pointless because you're doing nothing but setting yourself up for failure.
Right.
And what they're doing nowadays, they're hiding people. You go jump on a woman. Granted, it's a different ball game if a woman jumps on a man. Oh, it's funny games and women killing too. But when a man do it, it's frowned upon and it's looked down upon. And then, you know, my situation of it, like, man, I learned a lot from it. I lost a lot from it, which means I learned a lot from it. So
right.
It's like, y'all don't want to have me, but shit, I'll probably be the best guy to go talk to when it goes to talking to these women about dudes beating on them or men beating on women. I'm probably the best, too, because, man, I lost a lot in the instance of doing it. Yeah, I lost a lot, and I learned from it. That's what life is. Life is, it's not a life, it's a learning lesson. You're not living life, you are learning life. That's what you're doing. You're learning this shit because if you're not taught it, when it happens, it's bad.
I hear you.
Yeah?
No, it's well said. Well said.
But yeah, Ariel.
Good to catch up.
They don't want me because it's
all good. You're doing your thing. You're doing your thing in Ryzen. Congrats on that win. 7 seconds. You stole a lot of headlines. You look good. How are you, sir? Or ma'am?
That's my baby mama.
Okay. All right, I'll let you go, Charles. All the best. Good to catch up, and good luck on December 30th over there.
Oh, thanks, Ariel. I could use it.
All right, we'll talk to you soon.
Nigga, I don't need no. God. Ariel.
Yes.
You see this shit? What is that, man? What is that, man?
Okay. All right, I'll talk to you later.
You see, man? You let me talk this whole time with this hanging out, nigga?
Oh, my gosh. I did not. Yeah, I can hear you guys. There you go. I don't know. Did he hang up on me there or did we hang up on him? I'm not really sure what happened. Can you guys hear me? Am I okay? Okay. He hung up. My mic's still working though, right? All right. Okay. Well, that was certainly interesting. Thank you, Charles Bennett, for stopping by. Good luck getting that Vanderlei fight. Wow. That was something else. Mr. New York Rick, are you there? Can you turn down my audio just a little bit? It got really loud all of a sudden. Is New York Rick there?
I'm here. Can you hear me?
Oh, there he is. Welcome. I don't know what happened. Are you there? You can hear me, right?
I can hear you. Can you hear me?
Everything's gone upside down here. Welcome back.
Happened was when Charles pointed the camera at himself on the screen,
yeah,
it like broke, you know, the internet entirely.
The internet broke.
And that's why we're kind of suffering through it right now.
Honestly, I did not I did not see the booger in his nose.
I didn't either until he put it right up against there.
Okay, a lot to discuss, so let's get to it. How's your trip? Good, yeah? You missed us?
Did miss you.
Okay. Isn't it amazing that the time that you were gone, two of your favorite guests of all time were here?
Yeah, I feel like you did that to spite me.
Yes, accurate. And? No, I'm kidding. Tyron Woodley actually went out of his way. This guy is such a mensch that he went out of his way, changed his entire schedule just to join us in studio while he was here.
I know. That's why he's one of my favorites, and that's why you scheduled it for the time I'd be gone. Of course you did.
Anything you want to tell us about the trip?
Yeah, it was good stuff. Glory's got some cool stuff in the pipeline.
Okay. And where were you again?
Koh Samui, Thailand.
What is that where AKA Thailand is? No, that's in Phuket.
No, it's...
I saw you playing basketball, though.
Yeah, so the last night I was there, I got off the resort, went to watch some Muay Thai fights, and there was a basketball court. And I've noticed this when I'm traveling, much more so than when I'm home. It used to be... You go to any court in New York City and get a basketball game. No longer. Doesn't happen anymore.
Why?
The courts are empty. I don't know what happened. I get maybe it's, you know, kids going on their phones or their computers more than going out. But when you travel, 11 o'clock at night, midnight, people are out playing basketball. Always. And in Thailand, it was the same thing.
Did you school them?
Come on. They were like 10 years old.
Oh, okay.
So, of course, I schooled them.
You're kind of.
What, you thought I was going to say that I didn't? Oh,
that's the level that we're at.
How dare you, sir?
All right. Well, that is fun. Okay. So there's a lot to unpack from
there
this
really
past
is,
week.
Yeah.
Did you see the UFC 205 press conference?
I did.
First of all, scale of 1
it.
To 10.
Yeah.
Scale of 1 to 10. How good is that card? Is that the card? Did they get it right?
Yeah. I mean, I'm trying to think if there's a way to do a better card, and it's almost not possible.
Especially for the market. When you consider the Polish stuff with Joanna, when you consider Eddie from Philly, when you consider just Conor being Conor and the biggest star in the sport.
And you just think about the fact that you can't compromise every single fight you've had. Like, you can't do, you know, 8 title fights. You can't compromise the rest of the year. For all things considered, it's as good as it can get. A++++.
Do you agree with me that Jeremy Stephens actually won last week?
Oh, certainly. I mean, if anybody thinks that him getting his name out there was a negative, I mean, what could the argument possibly be? Now, did he get clowned? Did he get sunned? Obviously. Yeah.
But it was worth the risk.
100%. And you said it best when you were talking to Sean. Everybody else was quiet. If Frankie Edgar had been the one to kind of pipe up, people would be surprised and people would take notice. Jeremy Stephens happened to be the one to do it, and good for him. And for sure, it was a positive move for him.
Now, here's the thing. The Aldo backlash coming from Aldo, Nurmagomedov's upset. I'll repeat what I said on Thursday. I sympathize with those guys greatly. They are the number one contender, and we have been taught in this sport that if you win X amount, you win this fight, you're going to get a title shot, and that will lead to riches. Maybe you are already preparing for the title shot. Maybe you had already invested this, that, and whatever. But those guys, they would have done the exact same thing that Eddie Alvarez did. This is a life-changing fight for him. Not only the fight itself and the pay-per-view money, like that's the one thing that people are forgetting. Yeah, maybe he might still be on the same contract, but he's going to make a hell of a lot more than he ever did via pay-per-view. So they would have done the same thing. They need to be upset that they were told, and in the case of Khabib Nurmagomedov, was sent two bout agreements for a fight that never came to fruition. That's where their disappointment should be directed to, not towards the fighters who are just trying to advance and take part in the world of prize fighting, which at the end of the day is to get the biggest prize possible. So I understand 100% why they're upset. I don't think anyone should be blaming either, of course, Connor, he's the one who holds all the cards, or Eddie for taking the opportunity. There is no doubt in this world that a Eddie Connor fight would do a hell of a lot more buys, dollars, business than an Eddie Khabib fight. That's not saying I don't want to see the Khabib fight. And a lot of people said, including Khabib, Khabib is mad at me. I'll call it like this. I'll even go this far. Khabib Nurmagomedov, who I've had on this show multiple times, who I consider to be one of the very best fighters in the world, who I've called the uncrowned champion on this show, who I feel like I have a very good relationship with, has blocked me on Twitter. And he has blocked me on Twitter because he feels like I did not do a good enough job of selling the fact that he was the next guy, that he had this bout agreement. And what I told both him and his management was, you guys were used as pawns. That was never the fight that was in play. You guys were used as pawns. Remember what Conor McGregor said at the press conference? Conor McGregor said at the press conference that he had agreed to that fight 10 days prior. 10 days prior. If you look at the timeline, how could 10 days prior fall in with the bout agreement stuff, the deadline stuff, the foot being injured stuff? This is the game. And they wanted Eddie to agree to the fight on their terms, and he did. More power to him. And Khabib was used to try to put pressure on him. And he's upset at me for some reason. He's upset at Eddie for some reason. You need to be upset at the UFC for sending you these bout agreements and playing you like a puppet. That's who you need to be upset at. Hello?
I'm here.
That's all.
I wanted to get that off my chest.
Well, no, because Khabib... It says that like, oh, you're Team McGregor. And I tell him, like, words are very powerful. And even if you come back 30 minutes later and say, all right, you know, I was just kidding, we have a great relationship. Well, then BJPenn.com writes an article about it, as stupid as that is. And this guy picks up. And then you're now, you know, you're putting out this false reality that this is true. And I referred to that earlier. No, I knew what was going on. I knew exactly what was going on. And that's why I did not want to retweet your... As juvenile as this all sounds, it's disappointing to me that he's upset. But as juvenile as this all sounds, I did not want to play into that because I knew that at the end of the day, that was the fight that they wanted to make. And I knew that Connor had agreed to this fight days prior.
Fair, accurate, everything. But you have to understand that somebody who feels like they've been wronged is not always going to be... entirely rational.
No,
at this it's very early. It just happened. Give it some time, I'm sure.
Oh yeah, I mean, I'm not losing sleep over it. I am bummed. I've reached out to him. I've called him. I don't know why he's mad at me. I don't know what
but
I.
But that's
had
the thing. They're going to be mad at everybody.
Crazy. It's crazy.
They're going to be mad at everybody.
Yeah.
For now. But I mean, ultimately, I think we as people in this sport collectively got the fight that makes the most sense.
This
no?
is the biggest fight that they could have made.
Yeah.
It's the biggest card. It's the best. Those top three. It does feel a little weird that there's only one Longo Serra fighter on the card, and there are circumstances. Like, they didn't keep Vellante off the card. He was injured. The Iaquinta thing is unfortunate. Sterling, the timing didn't work out. Whatever. But top to bottom, it's a fantastic card. The prelims have Nurmagomedov Johnson, Evans Kennedy, Stevens Edgar. That's just the prelims. Six-fight main card. I pray to the... MMA gods that it all remains intact. So a lot of people are upset that they're not getting tickets, that the tickets are too expensive. I mean, this is the Conor show, and the UFC recognizes that they can make a lot of money off of it. I suspect that this will be the biggest gate in UFC history. I saw some people targeting like 18 or so million, which would far exceed UFC 129, which happened in Toronto, which is around, I think, 11 or 12 million. So this is a very big deal for the UFC. And, you know, Dana White, you know, it's unfortunate because, like, Dana even said himself, oh, it's Nurmagomedov and Eddie. And I think he's gone into this habit. Someone actually wrote to me on direct message. I won't say who. It was a fan. But he just wrote to me. He said, Dana is less calculated in what he says than he used to be. It seems nowadays he will say anything no matter how false and unproven it is. I like listening to what he has to say than immediately trying to figure out how much of it is BS. And, you know, a long time ago, Dana White told us that he will lie to the media if it serves his purpose. This came out when Ortiz was going to fight Liddell in the Ultimate, after the Ultimate Fighter, and then Ortiz got injured and Franklin stepped in and he denied it. And it's happened a bunch of times this year. And at some point, whatever you say is going to fall on deaf ears. But I thought that because you now have this reputation, but I thought what he told Newsday was perhaps one of the more accurate statements that he has said in a very long time, which was, I've got all these bean counters in my company who are telling me I'm devoting too much money to UFC 205. And I don't care because I promised a big card and I'm delivering a big card. And you got to give him props for that. He is certainly doing that.
Yeah, I think the New York thing would have been nice, you know, to have so many New York fighters on the card. It makes sense. But the UFC is not, you know, selling tickets like a local show. They don't need those people to draw, and they delivered the right. What is the best card. So I think that that takes precedence. It would have been great to have some more New York fighters, but I don't think that that's the priority.
How do you feel about the whole Cowboy Oliveira, Will Brooks thing?
Yeah. We had some questions about that, you know, one from Lamont 18, the usual guy, okay. who likes to drop them. I guess let's look at it from a bigger perspective. Should there be more of a punishment for missing weight?
Yes.
Because Will Brooks, for all intents and purposes, you know, is being punished, even though he's the one getting the, you know, the extra, what was it, 20%? Well, I forget what the fines are.
Yeah.
But he essentially has to take that fight to get his win bonus. As you were saying, you know, getting to fight night isn't enough. You need to also continue to fight to get your win bonus. So he's incentivized to fight a guy who looked significantly bigger than him in the cage. And it turns out that Will Brooks hurt himself and then had to take on an opponent while he was, you know, at a disadvantage. It was just a bad situation. And the current system incentivizes guys to do this. Is there a way around that, or does there need to be a way around that?
Well, first of all, I think that the win bonus needs to go away. I think that we've reached a point where if you sign on the dotted line to fight, you should get what you are owed. You know what I mean? And I'm not saying that they're withholding anything, but this idea that the fighters need more incentive, like 15 and 15, I feel like it should be 30 because they are already earmarking X amount to these fighters. And I know that they're not earmarking a win bonus for both, but I feel uncomfortable with the idea that like you need to prove something a little more, you need to do a little more. And sometimes, especially in this sport, when it comes down to these, you know, controversial judges' decisions, I mean, the guy and they do make it right a lot. I feel uncomfortable. Do you see what I'm saying about that? Like,
sure.
It should just be like, what's your purse? And that's it. End it. And then when it comes to the percentage that you get from your opponent when they miss weight, I mean, first off, no money should go to the commission. If there's any state that's still doing that, that's archaic and that's crazy. Second of all, there needs to be a tier. And I wish that they would look at that where, you know, it's like, I don't know, 5% for one, 10% for two, something to where there's no difference. Now there's no difference if you miss by 10 or you miss by, you know, like when Kelvin Gastelum missed against Tyron Woodley, and people forget about this, Woodley gave him back his money. I mean, that was a significant amount. That was even more than Cowboy Oliveira. So I felt for Will Brooks, a guy who just had a kid, just got married, takes the fight because he's not going to get his win bonus if he doesn't. Who knows if he gets his show bonus? I don't know if that was, to be honest, I don't know if that was offered to him. And then you get into the fight, and there's a clear, clear size advantage in Oliveira's favor. And Brooks loses, And then, in my opinion, Oliveira acted very unprofessionally. I don't care what he said about you. I don't care what you misunderstood. This all started because you were unprofessional and missed weight. I don't know what the reasons are. You have not explained the reasons, but you came in early. You missed weight by a significant amount. Take all that on the chin and say, you know what, man? We'll go our separate ways. I'm sorry that happened. Best of luck to you. But to do the crotch chop and the this and the that while the guy's there on the ground, I mean, I just thought it was an ugly scene. It really was.
Yeah, not good. That said, but what would be the incentive on the other side of it for an organization to institute to take away win bonuses? At this point, I don't see any reason that why they would.
And let's be clear, I don't want to take away win bonuses. I just feel like we've reached a point in the sport where guys should be agreeing to an amount, and they're getting that if they show up to the fight. Why is it structured this way? Why are there performance bonuses? Because they want guys to perform, because they want the sport to be as exciting as possible. But at this point, with people doing this for a living, guys are going to go out there and win. They're going to try to win. And, you know, they're going to try to win via a boring way. Everyone's going to try to win. I don't feel like guys need that incentive from a promoter anymore to say, look, all right, man, you're going to get $20,000, and guess what? By golly, if you win, you're going to get an extra $20,000. No, I feel like if you are prepared to pay someone $40,000, then if they sign on the dotted line and make weight and show up to fight, then they deserve that $40,000. So let me be very, very clear. I'm not saying get rid of win bonuses. I just wish that guys got a set amount. You see what I'm saying?
But that's currently how it is. It's just half.
No,
it's,
but you know how it is. You know what it's. They put that in place to incentivize guys.
Well, no, it's also why they have the back so that people don't show up and collect a paycheck and not fight.
Well, guys are doing that. I mean, there are boring fights anyways.
You could take that money, lay down, and then you get the same amount of money.
Oh, you're saying get knocked out and you're still getting paid?
Yeah.
I feel like this sport, the sport has reached a point.
Is it unique, though, to MMA? Boxing has it.
I'm talking about MMA has reached a point, in my opinion, where it's professional enough to where guys are laying a lot on the line that I'd love to see them not. Because, look, if Will Brooks didn't have the win bonus hanging over him, maybe he doesn't take the fight. Maybe he walks away with the same amount. He was a professional. He showed up. But look, it just doesn't make sense for me to agree to fight a guy who weighed in 5.5 pounds more than me.
Yeah.
I don't know. It's not going to happen. I just feel like the sport has... I mean, even the performance bonuses I don't love. I mean, look at what happened with John Dodson.
Yeah, I think it's just a... I don't know how I feel about what you're saying, because I think it's just a mechanism. Like, if I was a fighter, then what I would do is argue to get my show money higher, and therefore I'm guaranteed the whatever that number is, plus the win bonus. I think it's too big a bargaining tool for it to ever go away. But I think independent of that, this weight cutting thing can be completely overhauled regardless of show and win. And that you can be more incentivized to continue to fight even if your opponent misses weight badly.
Yeah. What else we got?
Lineker, what's next? It's tough because he's missed weight so many times. Not in this division. Yeah. I think this is his first miss in this division, but he just continues to miss weight.
But he moved up to this division because he was missing weight at 125.
And I said this, somebody reminded me on Twitter that I said this a while ago, that sometimes what happens is the guys go up to a higher weight class and then they miss weight there too.
Mm-hmm.
It's a discipline thing, and that discipline is going to carry over whether he's a flyweight or whether he's a bantamweight. It's not a situation where, oh, he has now 10 extra pounds. There's no way he's going to miss weight. But no, he's going to be shooting for 135 and he has discipline issues. So he may be very likely to miss weight, and that's what we saw.
By the way, Guilherme Cruz told me that at Jungle Fight, if you miss weight, you lose points in the fight.
Yeah.
So depending on how much you miss.
Think about this. This fight came down to two judges, one round, right? If he was docked a point for missing weight, it would have been Dodson's fight. Well, so that could
also
make all the difference.
Think about the hole that Cowboy Oliveira would have been in.
Oh, yeah.
Right?
I think, if I recall, I believe the judges had him winning the fight, right? They had him up.
Up until that point, yeah.
Up until that point. But it would have made it a closer fight for sure, and he would have had to change his game plan. I don't necessarily dislike that. I feel like that's definitely a good incentive for
Valide knows.
For guys missing weight. But what's next for John Lineker?
Well, this was his fourth fight as a bantamweight, so important to note it's the first time he misses weight. He missed by 0.5. He says that there was some sort of scale malfunction. I what I'm hearing now is that they're leaning towards Dillashaw versus Cruz rematch, as surprising as that may sound. And so I think if that's the case, then they're going to do Garbrandt versus Lineker.
Who's mad at that? I'm not.
No, but I kind of felt like with all the buzz that Garbrandt had
versus
and
Cruz,
the way they were pushing him, I thought they'd go in that direction. But again, it's hard to argue against Dillashaw. He was the champ. He lost a super close fight. But if they go in that direction, I foresee them doing Lineker versus Garbrandt. They might do Lineker versus Caraway. Caraway seems to be interested in it because I know they've been trying to get him into like a tough fight. But I think the history between Garbrandt and Lineker, and what a fight. I mean, oh my God, that'd be unbelievable. They're both so much fun. And the fight on Saturday was a lot of fun to watch. I feel like they'll go in that direction.
Can you put Lineker in a title fight?
Not now, no. He's shooting himself in the foot every time. You can't. If there is a person who continues to miss weight, this is the fifth time that he's missed weight in the UFC, whether it's at flyweight or bantamweight, you can't take that risk because if they miss weight, there's no title fight.
Yeah.
It's a big embarrassment.
How did you score that fight, by the way?
Ever so slightly for like the same thing that Sean Al-Shaadi had, so slightly for Lineker. Tough one. I mean, so hard. But yeah, ever so slightly. How about you?
Same. I had Lineker winning.
I think it was
2-3-4.
Yeah, exactly. I was gonna say Dotson 1-5, Lineker 2-3-4.
Absolutely. Jose Aldo. We touched on this.
Yeah.
You touched on this earlier. We touched on it a little bit here. Do you think that this is the last we've seen of Jose Aldo in the UFC?
Oh,
or
my.
Do you think it'll be resolved?
Before I answer that, let me give a quick update on Josh Saman.
Yes, please.
Mark Ramundi of MMAfighting.com posting this around an hour and 45 minutes ago. Law enforcement officers found UFC fighter Josh Saman unresponsive and his friend dead in a Florida home Thursday evening. The Hollywood, Florida Police Department said Monday in a statement. Saman was breathing and had a pulse but was not responding. The deceased was identified as Troy Kirkenberg, Saman's friend and the announcer for Saman's Florida MMA promotion. Police responded to the, quote, call of a possible drug overdose, end quote, per the statement. Saman and Kirkenberg were found by a friend, Hunter Sundberg, who called 911 and administered CPR until police arrived, the release said. Police said there was no sign of foul play, and detectives are currently investigating. Saman, 28, has been in the hospital since Thursday in a coma. Per the Tallahassee Democrat, he was in critical condition as of Saturday morning. Since then, not a lot of updates. So that's the crux of the story. Considering everything he has been through, very sad stuff. And again, I really, really hope and pray that he is able to pull through this. Okay, so going back to Jose Aldo, tough one to predict because if this was an isolated incident, I feel like there was a better chance of them fixing it, but it feels like for quite some time he has been unhappy and he's just had enough.
Well, is this a unique scenario? Because I think it is, where a champion like him, who's been a champion for so long in this featherweight division, and has stayed undefeated, gone undefeated in a stretch for so many years, and was considered one of the pound-for-pound best in the sport, has been so disrespected in the sense that it seems like he can't even get a response or can't get a fight when he's, you know, one of the top guys who's competed in this sport for a long time. I don't think it's typical for a guy like him to be treated in this way. I feel like this is a pretty unique scenario. So for him asking to be released, it's almost one of a kind. Am I crazy? Can you think of another guy who's been as good as he has that's essentially not been able to get a shot at his former title?
Also, let's not forget that Frankie Edgar should have gotten that shot first. and he lost to Jose Aldo, and that's why Aldo's in the position that he is now. Did he deserve an immediate rematch? Sure. I mean, you could definitely make that case. He has certainly warranted it. But let's not forget that, you know, if Aldo thinks he was screwed, then Edgar was kind of screwed too, because he beat Chad Mendez and was told essentially that he's next.
Yes, but Frankie Edgar isn't Jose Aldo. Frankie Edgar doesn't have the years in that division that
I'm just saying
champion.
The whole thing is kind of a mess. And hopefully once this fight happens, and if Conor wins the lightweight title, that we'll have a little more clarity. Now, I will say this. I've been asked this question a million times by people. What is Conor's big announcement? What is Dana White alluding to when he's saying that? Okay, Conor does not have a big announcement as it pertains to his fighting. If I'm guessing, how can I say this? He probably would have preferred if Dana didn't make this statement, this sort of vague statement. But I can assure you that he is not retiring. He doesn't have plans of dropping the belts, as he said at the press conference. And if you're hoping for some big earth-shattering announcement as it pertains to Conor McGregor fighting, you are going to be disappointed. Don't worry. There's nothing to worry about as it pertains to his fighting. And the rest is, you know, his business, and that's it. But please, if you can, stop asking me about Conor McGregor's announcement, because there is no announcement, and it really has nothing to do with. I think there might have been a misunderstanding, or someone may have misspoke. That's what, I don't know. I'm being vague, but it's not for us to discuss or talk about. And it's nothing bad, by the way. It's absolutely nothing bad from what I'm told. Just everyone just forget about it is what I'm trying to do. And I know that's not gonna.
Yeah, that's going to do well.
But I had to answer it at some point, because it's like I'm getting 1,000 questions. What's Conor's announcement? Is he retiring? It's amazing how much false stuff is put out there. So I'm trying to help everyone.
Yeah,
okay?
Don't look at the man behind the curtain. And something now like that. Everybody's going to look.
I don't know. I don't know what's going to happen with Jose Aldo. It's a very tricky situation, but I believe him when he says he wants out. I've asked them to come on the show. They said thanks, but no thanks. Right now, I don't think he wants to do a lot of media, but we'll see. Hopefully they make it right to both him and Khabib. I mean, Khabib is fighting on the card, so he seems like he's pretty happy with how things have turned out.
This one sticks in my craw a little bit.
Why?
Well, Khabib is, again, no, Jose Aldo has the the gravitas. He has the clout to be able to make this kind of stink about this. I don't feel like Khabib has it. I don't feel like Frankie Edgar has it, quite frankly. This guy was the featherweight champion. There were no other featherweight champions for his entire career. I think he has the right to kind of be a little bit upset about not getting a shot at that belt.
I don't think anyone's saying he doesn't have the right.
But more so than almost anybody else. Could you imagine if after Anderson Silva lost to Chris Weidman, it took him forever to get back to that title shot? They just said, you know what? We're not really interested in having you fight. And just kept him on the shelf, or threw him in a fight that just would, you know, spend some time in the division. I think
But what was the alternative here? Doing Aldo versus McGregor?
Or vacate the belt. Give him the shot.
I mean, look, it's hard to deny what Conor is trying to do, or anything that he says, or anything that he wants, because he equals massive business for the UFC. I mean, if he wasn't the draw that he was and the star that he was, then they could say, you know what, man, sit down, shut up, and take the fight that we're giving you. You're the champion, defend your title. But everything he touches turns to gold.
Is that second strap the thing that's making him a pay-per-view draw? Is going after another title while holding the featherweight title?
I mean, he has said this from the first interview we did, and before that, he wants to be a two-weight world champion. And it was going to be a very easy, quick thing. He was fighting in March against RDA. RDA gets hurt, and then the Nate thing happens, and that turned into big business for the UFC two times, the highest-selling pay-per-view.
Without a belt?
Without a belt, yeah.
So my question is,
he wants to be, this is something, it's not something that he came up with, you know, yesterday. He wants to be the two-way world champion.
Right, but if they took it off him, is that going to be the difference between that pay-per-view at MSG selling or not selling? Because
no,
I think it makes zero difference.
I think he wants that distinction. That means a lot to him. And I think that there is value to that. history being made, history at the first
UFC. My favorite fighter is BJ Penn, who held two different belts at different times, and that's still a significant thing. Holding two UFC belts at the same time would be monumental.
This is a guy who wants feathers in his cap.
Matters if he wants that, because I think if they stripped that belt from him, he could still headline this event, have the same pay-per-view drawing power, wouldn't make a damn difference in the world, and Jose Aldo could compete for the featherweight title. And
but does he want that title?
In fact, it would create a storyline.
Does he want that title, or does he want Conor for the title? Like, would you want that?
That's a question.
Would you want that title? You know what I mean? Like, you lost to the guy. You want another chance. And he deserves another chance. And I kind of feel like after this fight, which is not that far away, he will get the other chance. I mean, let's not forget, Jose Aldo fought in July. He's gone through stretches of over a year without fighting. So if Conor wins or loses in November and is ready to go in, I don't know, March, April, that's still less than a year. I mean, that's kind of his average. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. The shoe is on the other foot. He's the one chasing now, so he's a little more anxious.
I don't blame him. He has the resume. He's done enough. But I think Eddie, given the fact that he's the champion at 155, given the fact that he's from nearby Philadelphia, was the fight to make. And
no,
it's fresher.
No doubt about it. That's
also,
the fight to make
forget,
for Conor.
Let's not forget that we went through the whole, you know, world tour and everything, and the fight fell through. I personally think, business-wise, the UFC makes a hell of a lot more money with Eddie because it's a fresh matchup.
No doubt.
Somewhat tired, and he sells the fight a little better.
I'm not arguing for Aldo versus McGregor. I'm arguing for Aldo fighting for the featherweight belt.
I don't even know if that makes him happy.
If that's the case, then there's no pleasing him, and he can't be talked
I said
to.
A long time ago that, you know, belts have never meant less, but I feel like the real statement is, like, once you get the belt, more so than ever, you are the
in
king
the driver's
of the
seat. Yeah, sure.
And look at this weekend with Bisping and Hendo.
Yeah.
Which, you know, I'm all, you know, it's a good build up, and the fight's gonna be over this time next week, and then they can move on. But, like, we need to stop sticking to this meritocracy where, you know, number one's going to fight. It's just not, it's never going to be that way. It never will be that way.
It won't. Agreed. But doesn't it matter in some capacity?
Especially, by the way, in this day and age where the owners of the UFC just bought the UFC for $4 billion. They're trying to make a lot of money. They're trying to make a lot of money as quickly as possible. How crazy is that whole thing, right?
It's super interesting.
They've got 23 new celebrity investors, most of which, by the way, are a part of some kind of union. I mean, this is the craziest thing. Who would have ever... it's so bizarre what has happened this year. Who would have thought The Weeknd and Conan and Tom Brady and, you know, who else? The list, Sylvester Stallone, I think, is on that list. It's just a crazy mix of characters who have now invested in the UFC. What's his name? Guy Fieri.
Yeah.
And many, many more. I mean, look, I think once the sale happened, once that $4 billion number was attached to the UFC, once the new owners invested all that money in the UFC, they're going to try to make as much money as possible as quickly as possible. Because they, you know, this idea that, oh, look how much these guys spent on the UFC, now they're going to pay the fighters more, to me always never made any sense, because these aren't the current owners. I'll tell you where it gets a little confusing. Like, let's look at the last big transaction in sports. Donald Sterling was kind of forced to sell the Clippers to Steve Ballmer for $2 billion. Donald Sterling didn't stick around after that sale and continue to make personnel decisions, signing players, etc. But Dana White, who made around $400 million, who then signed a five-year deal and is making multi-millions of dollars, is still around cutting the deals. So that's one thing that I don't know if they took into account when they were trying to figure out the long-term plan. It gets a little dicey when you're talking to a Chris Weidman or an Iaquinta or an Aldo or an Eddie Alvarez, and you're like, nah, you know, we just can't pay you this extra $100,000, $200,000 when you just pocketed this and are still around. It's not like you're the new regime and you're like, look, our hands are tied. We paid this much. We can only afford this much. People are thinking like, well, wait a second. You just made $400 million and you're still here. Do you get what I'm saying?
Sure.
It's a very unique thing that is playing out in front of us.
Yes or no? Is Ronda Rousey still the biggest UFC star, which was said recently?
Yeah, Dana White. No, I don't think that's true at all.
Conor McGregor, clearly, yes.
It's not even close.
Also,
do you agree with me?
Absolutely.
I mean, not only is he the face, he's the biggest draw, and he's always been the biggest draw.
Yeah, and I think there's, it's a vague term, star, quote unquote star. When you're measuring numbers, when you're measuring dollars and cents, clearly Conor McGregor is the breadwinner in this scenario. But maybe in terms of bringing in new audiences, you know, fight fans and people who are on the fence about, you know, fighting are definitely going to be enamored with Conor McGregor. But I think that Ronda has a bit of a drawing power that goes beyond that to people that may not have even been interested in all at all, and she draws them in.
Sure.
But in terms of figures, it's Conor McGregor, clearly.
It's actually not even close at this point. Ronda's a big draw, but she's not on his level at this point. And I think that by continuing to try to tell us otherwise doesn't do Ronda any favors. Now, you're right. Ronda opens doors that Conor can't.
Yeah.
And she gets the sport in front of eyeballs that no one could have ever dreamed of. But those eyeballs don't necessarily turn into pay-per-view dollars.
Yeah. And you know what I mean? And not potentially long-term pay-per-view dollars. But Conor McGregor seems to be...
I mean, the
keeping
guy,
that train rolling.
I was sitting there in New York. I mean, they could legitimately charge for his pay-per-views, and people would pay for it. If they charge $3.99, excuse me, for his press conferences. If they charge $3.99 for his press conferences, people would pay for it.
I don't think you're wrong. I don't think you're wrong on that. Any update about UFC 206, Canada, your home?
Yeah, what's going on? You know, they've put so much time and attention into 205 that I think they're going to start now paying attention to 206 a little more. As far as main events and things like that, I've heard some, but too early to talk about. Of course, the big one is George St. Pierre. That negotiation continues to go. I don't know why they keep wanting to tell us that George doesn't want to fight when he I know unequivocally 1,000% he wants to fight. It would make all the sense of the world. I mean, I would love to see GSP versus Damian. I would love to see GSP versus Nick. I just want to see GSP back now that he wants to come back, and I think it would be great for Canadian MMA. But there isn't much to say as far as, you know, who's going to be on the card. That's for sure. It's unfortunate, but we'll see. I mean, let's look at it. Stipe is not going to be on the card, although a champion from Ohio fighting on that card would make a lot of sense. Cormier, maybe. Bisping said last week, I know you weren't here, but Bisping said that he beats Hendo, he'd have no problem fighting GSP in Toronto. So who knows? Maybe they're waiting for him. I wonder how Weidman and all those guys would feel about that. Then the 170 title is in New York. 155 is Eddie. 145 is Connor. Dominic, maybe, although I don't think it makes a lot of sense to have two guys who, you know, are from California fighting in Toronto, although they did fight in Boston in January, so I guess that doesn't really make much of a difference. And then Demetrius is fighting in early December. Ioana's fighting in November. And then Amanda Nunes and Ronda, they're targeting December 30th. So I think it kind of comes down to the light heavyweight and bantamweight division at this point, as far as main events are concerned. And then if you can add GSP to that, you got a pretty good card.
Yeah. Does it need GSP is a question.
I think Canadian MMA needs GSP, yeah.
Let me clarify. By need, I mean, is this card going to be sufficient? Is it going to satisfy the Canadian audience without GSP? Need in the most literal sense. Like, does this need GSP?
I definitely feel like a rising tide will lift all boats, that if GSP returns, it will be a very big deal for all. I mean, who knows? Next week this time, John Jones is having his hearing in Nevada.
Mm.
You know, he's fought in Toronto, although I don't know if it's smart to go with him a fourth time in Toronto, though it has been around three or so years since the last card in Toronto, as crazy as that sounds. So we'll see. I do think that they need GSP. Like, does the card crumble? Does it go down the toilet? No, but there's a big difference between having him and not having him. I think having him on the card, as soon as the tickets go on sale, they will sell out. Not... And they don't sell out right away. You get what I'm saying?
Yeah. And also, you know, without Rory, the Canadian fans...
I mean, there's no real next in line, right?
Yeah.
There's no real... I mean, there's some guys coming up. There's, you know, OAM, Olivier Aubin-Mercier. There's the Chad Laprises of the world. But there's no like real. Jordan Meehan is coming back.
Oh yeah, that's right. Forget about Jordan.
There's no real like you know superstar that everyone's really excited about that can be a star in the making and a real draw over there.
Yeah, the next guy to kind of rally behind, and
it's really still the GSP show.
It is. What else you got?
Well, we can call Jason Perillo.
I can do that. You want to just rap for a few minutes while I do that?
Yeah, sure. I'll rap. Speaking of Toronto, how about my Toronto Blue Jays? I mean, wow, what a win that was. I'm still exhausted from that. The backs against the wall, and then they win 2 out of 3 in Boston. Wild card game tomorrow. There is nothing like playoff baseball. I'm finally getting to experience it. Never got to experience it as an Expos fan, and I still maintain that the better the Blue Jays do, the Expos have a better chance of coming back, so that's what I'm hoping for. But it is very exciting stuff. I was sweating yesterday. I was listening to the game on my phone on the SiriusXM app all day walking around with my family, and I would just like blurt out things like, yes, like, oh no. And my wife would look at me like, what happened? Not realizing that I was actually listening to the baseball game, but wow, was it exciting. She was getting really annoyed, very pissed off, but I was loving it. Juan 2-1, spoiled the David Ortiz party. It was great. And my Buffalo Bills beat the New England Patriots. I've still not watched it down. I'm still holding out. I don't know anything about the Ryder Cup, but thanks for trying, though. The Buffalo Bills skunking the New England Patriots. I mean, how exciting was that? All right, so in a minute, we're going to be joined by Jason Perillo, who is the coach for one Michael Bisping. And what a stretch it has been for Jason Perillo. Chris Cyborg last weekend, main event, and the numbers came out. Huge ratings draw. Once again, more proof that she needs to just main event these cards as champion, that she's a big enough draw as champion, that she warrants starting their own division, 145 featherweight division. Trust me. Trust me on this one. Take my word. It will be big business. So he had her, Bisping this weekend, and then BJ Penn in Manila. That's very exciting stuff. Let's see the card this weekend, shall we? And can you just turn down my audio just a little bit? It's a little loud in my ears. I appreciate it. So UFC 204, like I said, taking a couple hits. The fights that I am eyeing right now, of course, Bisping, Henderson, Vitor, Gegard Mousasi. OSP versus Jimmy Manoa, solid fight at 205. Stefan Struve versus Daniel Omelianchuk. This doesn't have the new lineup. Da-na-na-na-na. No one has the new lineup. Oh, I guess they didn't. Oh, yeah, that's right. Because they had Mirsad Bektik against Jeremy Kennedy after Arnold Allen got injured, but as of now, I don't think that they've added a fifth fight to the pay-per-view card. Brad Pickett on the card. The one I'm really looking forward to, when I was in London, for Bisping versus Anderson Silva, there was a guy there whose name escapes me at the moment, and I'm sorry, I think he was in some ways related to Michael Bisping, told me, Mark Diakesi is the guy to watch as far as English MMA is concerned, UK MMA is concerned. Look out for him. That is a name to remember. And he is making his UFC debut. Our friends over at Severe MMA have a nice little video on Mark up there. Very exciting fighter. He's fighting on the Fight Pass prelims. So look out for Mark. Also, Mike Perry is back. Remember Mike Perry from UFC 202? He's back. Pretty quick turnaround for Mike Perry. Platinum Perry. He's fighting Danny Roberts, Fight Pass prelims. Leon Edwards versus Albert Tumanov is a great fight as well. Any other ones? And like I said, Brad Pickett fighting at home. So that's this Saturday. If you're in England, it's all going down very, very, very late in the evening or early in the morning. The main event is supposed to happen at around 5 a.m. local time. But here in the United States, I know some people are confused about this. Here in the United States, it's actually happening normal time, 10 p.m. Eastern time, 7 p.m. Pacific, And it will end at around 1, like always. Also, it has gone under the radar, but World Series of Fighting has a card this weekend as well. And it's one of their better cards in a very long time. Again, World Series of Fighting makes a habit out of putting on events at the same time as the UFC. I don't know why they do this, but I can assure you it's not the promoters. It's really more of an NBCSN thing. They're looking for openings, and they think that it makes sense to put a card. I mean, I wish they would do it on Fridays like Bellator does, so all the attention could be on them. I think it would go, you know, a very long way for them, and it would be very beneficial for them if they did this, but they're not doing it. Justin Gaethje, always fun to watch him fight. Main card is on at 11, by the way, and it is a six-fight main card. But check out this card. So Gaethje is defending his lightweight title against Ozzy. This one is always tough for me, especially 3+ hours in. Dugulubkov. I butchered that. That is bad. Anyhow, David Branch versus Vinny Magalhaes for the light heavyweight title. Jason High is on the card. Brian Foster is on the card. John Howard's on the card against Nurmagomedov's brother. Sean Jordan making his World Series of Fighting debut. That is a solid card. That's one of their best cards ever. Taking place in Kansas City, by the way. Kansas City. Let me see what's going on here. Any sign? Oh, we do. All right. All right, let's go to our last guest of the day. Let's finish off right. Big weekend for him on Saturday, UFC 204. His guy, Michael Bisping, defends his title for the very first time against Dan Henderson. He is one of the very best coaches in the sport, Jason Perillo, and he joins us via the magic of Skype right now. Jason, how are you?
Hey, Ariel. How you doing, man?
I appreciate you joining us. Thank you very much.
Hey, thanks for having me.
So you're in Manchester right now, right?
I'm Manchester, and I'm in Manchester's finest spa in town right now.
Really? What are you doing there?
Good. I just came over. They wanted the champ here at the finest spa in town, so we got salt steams and just a lot of really relaxing. What's it called? Hale Country Club's the name.
Oh, wow. Look at you.
That's it. Yeah. Big time, huh?
Now, did I take you away from a spa session?
You know what? We were just finishing it up, and no, not at all.
Okay.
Not at all.
Well, it's a pleasure to have you. I was talking about this before you got on. What a stretch this is for you, because you were in Brazil last weekend for Chris Cyborg, right? Now Manchester.
Correct.
And are you going to Manila for BJ as well?
It is in the plan. We're just trying to iron that out, because I mean, I've been doing a lot of traveling and trying to figure out. Yeah, the plan is that. That is the plan.
Sure. Have you ever had a stretch like this before? 3 main events in 4 weeks all over the world?
No, never. I got 3 continents all over the. I mean, yeah, no, I haven't. It's pretty heavy. I've been pretty much jet lagged since I left to Brazil.
Oh, someone's calling you. This happens sometimes when people call you in the middle of Skype session, or the Wi-Fi at this country club went out. We'll get him back. Remember. Oh, there he is. Did someone call you, Jason?
Sorry about that.
Oh, no problem. So you've never had a stretch like this before. Is it not really ideal in the sense that, you know, you're in Brazil with Chris, you can't spend those last days with Michael, and then you can't, you know what I mean? Like, it must...
Oh, yeah.
Right?
Yeah, it's been a little bit of a cluster. It has. I just stay in, trying to be in the most important parts of this last couple of weeks with each guy that I've been working with. BJ, unfortunately, I haven't, you know, been with for the last couple of weeks, but he's out in Albuquerque, and we all know there's good training out there. So my guess is, from what I hear, he's looking really good out there. His brother connected with Jackson out there, and Jackson said to JD that he was doing very well. So that's good to know. Again, I've been out in Brazil. I did miss a week with Mike, but Mike is a focused dude, and he stays training 24 hours. You never have to worry about that guy.
I want to get your take quickly on Chris, because as her coach, you want your athlete to perform at the highest level possible. Do you wish that she would stop fighting at 140? Do you feel like it is a detriment to her as an athlete when she fights below 145?
Of course. I mean, I've talked about that for years with her and with, you know, with the team, and it's always been the biggest concern of mine. I mean, 145, you saw that grueling weight cut on that documentary that Chris had done, and you know, that was coming down to 140, but believe it or not, those are the same grueling weight cuts that she has at 145. I've yet to see a really easy one at 145. She's just, you know, willing to make that mental sacrifice over the last couple fights and shed off those last 5 pounds, which, you know, shows what kind of champion she is, right?
Yeah. So do you want to see her stop fighting at 140? Should those days come to an end?
Well, here's the thing. Chris is a champ. She's going to do what she wants to do. She's going to go where, you know, you're the money and the tent, you know, and where she's recognized as being the best, because that's the type of mentality she's got. I just personally don't see what's the difference between, I mean, if it's a super fight, it's a super fight. You know, they don't, there's no division. They don't want to make a 145 pound division, but guess what? There's no 140 pound division either. Is there?
Right, right.
So what's the difference?
Right.
You know, it's a super fight. You know, it's a super fight. We can make a super fight. You can make a super fight at 153 if you want.
Right.
142. 144. It's a super fight. It's a fight that's happening with no weight class. So, you know, why not put that 145 pound thought out there in people's eyes? Because there are plenty of girls out there. They got girls in Invicta. You know, the 135 pound division isn't that stacked, from what I understand.
Oh, someone's calling him again. Jason Perillo, a very popular guy over there in Manchester. Oh, I went on this whole rant about World Series of Fighting. Their card is actually on Friday. Jason, you back?
Yeah, I'm back.
Okay, go ahead.
I'm sorry. I keep on getting blown up here. I apologize.
Who's calling you?
I stopped them from calling.
I don't know.
I think it's Vegas, actually, because they just discovered. I lost my Reebok bag at LAX.
Okay.
And I just got an email saying that it was sent to the UFC office in Vegas. So, and I left them a message. It's a 702 number, so my guess, it's them calling to let me know about my bag, but I don't know why they'd do it twice.
Yeah, seriously. I mean, don't they know that you're on the most important damn show in the world here? Jesus.
Well, Jesus Christ. I it's such an important show. I took time out of my spa to come.
I know. Are you wearing a robe right now? Is that what you're doing?
I am, and I'm trying not to fucking get it here in the camera. I'm trying to keep it up high.
I thought you were wearing like a nice sweater, but now I see.
Like, I was going to put a t-shirt on, but I'm like,
this is a hey. Yeah. Hey, Michael.
He's killing his spa, Ariel.
I'm sorry.
Right,
I wanted to.
Soul caves. We got Zen rooms. We got, you name it, we've got it here. We are living the life of luxury. Champion lifestyle is very, very nice. Big shout out, Hail Country Club. Big shout out, Mike Protein. I'll stop hijacking his interview. Ariel, you're the man.
You're the man, Mike. Best of luck to you. That is an amazing thing. I just wanted to get the man behind the man. That's all. I wanted to give you some of that attention because I do feel, quite frankly, like you don't get enough of that attention, if I'm being honest. I mean, look at the stretch of fights you got coming up. Do you kind of feel that way as well, Jason, that you don't get enough love?
Not at all. I'm being serious with you. I don't think about it because, you know, my focus, you know, they always say, you know, a coach is a thankless job. So you got to already kind of accept that, you know, being a coach, you know, I was a fighter and that didn't turn out the way I wanted to. So, you know, my job is trying to bring the best out of these guys. And, you know, if I do get some positive attention from it, I really appreciate it, you know, because I've had negative attention from it before in the past, you know, and I appreciate guys like yourself reaching out to me and asking me my side of stories. So, I don't think one way or other whether I'm getting enough attention or not. I'm doing a lot of traveling, so it's hard to think about anyways,
that is,
right?
That is true. Okay, for a guy who helped reinvent Michael into the fighter and champion that he is today, what is it like for you now as you prepare for his first title defense? Does anything change, or are you guys doing the same thing?
No, it's exciting. We're doing the same thing, and and believe it or not, the pressure gets stronger and stronger. We fought the last couple of fights, we fought the best in the world, you know, pound for pound guys that are phenomenal and very difficult to beat. You know, it becomes a different shift in our pressure, obviously, with, you know, Mike being more favored in this fight, and they haven't had a loss to him in the past. So, you know, there's just as much, if not more, pressure on this fight. But Michael is handling it like a champion in a big a big turn in the corner, a big change in our game. It's just how Mike's handling his calmness and able to handle all the situations he's in, whether it's, you know, from the press to the weigh-ins to the week of the fight. Everything he does is, you know, he's calm, cool, and collect, and he wants to fight that way, so he's really living that way.
Can I tell you what was one of my favorite moments of 2016? Michael Bisping wins, and the shot of you stand up, and you just cross your arms. I mean, holy crap. Might be the greatest celebration in the history of MMA as far as corners are concerned. There's so much excitement. Everyone's freaking out, and you just stand up and cross your arms. What is going through your mind?
I just, it's something that I knew was going to happen. I really, you know, you believe, I mean, coaches have a whole visionary thing going on with them as well. And you know, Destin, I told you so. I grew up in a household where, you know, when my father was right, that's how he let you know he's right. You know, he'd cross his arms and let you know, I told you so, you know, whatever situation it is. And that was kind of my thought process that was going on. I was real confident Michael was going to catch him. He was really setting up that left hook and putting everything together very well. You know, he had Rockhold guessing there and he set up that left hook, and I watched him do it, and I knew what was happening as it was going on.
So that was your big FU to all the doubters, right? All the odds makers, all that? 100,000%.
It was a big FU to the doubters. It really was, because we got to get our moments.
Right.
It's an up and down game, this fight game. You know, we got to get our little cross our arm moment, right?
Did you plan on that, or was that 100% authentic? Like in the moment, it just happened?
It really came. That's just that was. I probably do that. I it's not something I don't do. I do that in other aspects of my life.
Oh, okay.
Talk to my girlfriend when I'm right. She'll let you know.
It was amazing. I could watch that over and over again. A beautiful moment. So.
Oh, thanks.
What an interesting turn of events that was, because you only had 2.5 weeks. Have you tried to learn from that in the sense that, okay, maybe Michael Bisping is the kind of fighter that doesn't need a lot of reps, it doesn't need a lot of, you know, weeks of training? Like for this camp, have you done less weeks than you've done in the past with him because of how good that fight went?
Well, we have just without having. See, what happened is Michael got booked with, and we knew this ahead of time, even starting camp, that Michael had a movie booked. Where was that, Mike, in London?
London,
yeah, he had a movie book in London. And we know it's perfect time because it's right in the gut of our training. Mike's ready to fight 3 weeks into training camp, and this happened to fall into the fourth and fifth week of training camp, which gave us a tour. Okay, hold on. I'm bringing the camera. I got the champs calling here.
Okay. What do we got?
As we've said, 2 weeks, 2 days, 2 minutes. It doesn't matter. We're chilling like villains.
I like it. So what a life.
Look at this guy. Look at this guy. Lean mean.
Whoa. Lean mean. What did he say yesterday?
Is he still that same guy from Clitheroe? I mean, has fame gotten to him?
The beach is that way, Aaron.
Hey, not many boys in Clitheroe probably hanging out.
No, it's a good look. Well done.
No, but where I was at was, yeah, we knew we had that movie that he was going to do in the gut of the training, which was a blessing in disguise, because both me and him even talked about it. We knew that he was going to go out, he's going to stay running, he's going to stay training. He had Daz Morris, a guy that he worked for with years out here in England. He was able to come out and work with him, and, you know, during the filming, and just keep him conditioned, you know. And really, it, you know, the way we were looking at it really happened, you know, perfectly, because he really has been peaking this last week. He's stopping guys, knocking guys out in the gym. He's, you know, all cylinders are firing. He's not overtrained. Right now, the biggest focus is focus and just staying relaxed and calm and being confident in what we got going on Saturday night.
When you watch his fight at 100 against Dan and you look at Michael Bisping, is he a complete, like, is it not even worthwhile to watch that? Is he a completely different fighter now?
No, it's a little worthwhile just to, you know, look at what we don't want to do.
Right.
You know, but, you know, the temperament of Michael Bisping was a little bit different back then. He was a little younger. You know, he's had a lot more experience than that. And in my opinion, Mike's really peaking in his career. you know, not just in training, in this training camp, but in his career, he's really peaking, and everybody peaks at different times. Some guys are the best when they're in their 20s, and, you know, some guys, you know, we all, you know, a lot of guys peak at different times, and Mike's really come together, you know, mentally, physically, and emotionally, and he brings it in, and he's a champion now, and I really do believe he's peaking, and I think he's gonna keep showing that for the next handful of fights.
So you were very confident against Rockhold. You knew the left hand would be there, the left hook, and it came to fruition. What are you foreseeing in this fight?
You know, I see him touching him with whatever he wants. I see him reading Dan, reading his movements. Mike's been in front of a lot of good fighters, good punchers, you know, good everything. I mean, Luke Rockhold's a beast. He's a beast, and he was reading him like a book. Anderson Silva's a beast, and he was reading him like a book. I mean, Dan Anderson has a whole different – he's got a different arsenal as far as his leverage and his power, but he also shows a lot more than these other guys do. They are a little bit more coordinated, a little bit more athletic, a little bit more quicker. And reading guys like that, he's just going to bring it right over in the cage with Dan, obviously. He's going to have to be cautious. He's going to have to focus, and that's what's most important because – Mike knows how to react to whatever he needs to react to, and it's keeping the head right and the focus and keep plugging away. You know, he's going to hit him with everything.
Do you expect an early finish again?
I expect it, it won't shock me. I'll be crossing my arms if it does happen.
Okay.
I'll tell you that.
Okay.
Definitely arm crossed if it happens early, because it wouldn't shock me. It really doesn't. But, you know, I think it's going to depend on Mike's temperament and how he wants to, you know, and how he feels with Dan, because we're not all in there. And we could feel a guy, and we could feel how a guy's reading us sometimes, and they can feel how they're reading you. You know, you could feel that's what fighting is. That's something that's the unknown area that, you know, us fans, us, you know, coaches, or, you know, us journalists, everybody outside watching, you know, you don't feel what they're feeling in there sometimes. I'm pretty in tune to that type of thing. That's where I have some success, when I get real connected with my athletes, because, you know, I get a feeling of where they're at when I know them very well. And I think Mike's going to be able to dictate it however he wants. It's just, you know, making sure he feels good in there.
Let me ask you this before I let you go and get back to the spa. The last time we had you on the show was right after that BJ Penn Frankie Edgar fight, and that turned into, you know, I don't know if debacle is the right word, but you were being criticized. It just didn't end well. How did you link up with BJ again, and with him going to Jackson's, how do you fit into that whole equation?
Well, I think what BJ says to me, he said it to me about 3 or 4 times when he was out in, you know, Vegas. He always says, you know, when shit hits a fan, we call PZ, we call Perello, you know what I mean? and that's, you know, that's just sarcasm there. But really, at the end of the day, me and BJ have always been a day, regardless of where we've been training. You know, we started off coach and fighter, but we got a close bond. We became really good friends, and, you know, and BJ over the years has always called me, and whether he takes my advice or doesn't take my advice, but he's always, you know, talked to me, you know, and knows that we have a long history, and knows that I know him very well, just like I do Michael and these other fighters. And, you know, he trusts what I have to say. So I think he really wanted to, he came out and saw me for a couple of weeks, and I think a main purpose, and we did work some boxing and whatnot, but, you know, he really wanted to get his mind where he wanted to be, you know what I mean? And for some reason, as a coach, I think you have to have that. You know, there's plenty of trainers in this sport. You know, there's trainers up and down. There's trainers on TV all the time on these UFC fights. But there's, you know, you don't find a whole lot of coaches that actually you know, think about, you know, that they're able to be to get to their fighters psychologically and mentally, and also knowing all the positions and fundamentals of the fight game too, as well. You know, a lot of times you have one or the other. You know, I feel like I'm lucky enough to be around this long enough to have an understanding of the dynamics of the physical aspect of the fight game, but also, you know, the mental aspect of the game. And me and BJ are always close, and he knows that. You know, he can have, and his brother said it to me the other night. He says, you know, BJ can have 10, 20 guys in the corner. He's always going to make sure, he's always going to look back and see if Perello's in the corner. So, you know, which is, you know, he's got a lot of trust for me. And again, we have never fallen out, even though I took a lash and a shit for a long time. BJ did come out publicly, you know, apologize to me even. And that's something you're not going to see BJ Penn do. And, you know, and we still just never stop talking because it's not his fault. You know, it's not my fault either. It's just, you know, that's a relationship that we've had for years, and he knows that I always have his back, and I'll be there for him if he needs me.
All right, I'll let you go, Jason. Thank you very much for the time. What a stretch this is for you. So you got the first one down. Chris Cyborg looked great against Lena Landsberg. Saturday, you've got Bisping, and then next weekend, BJ Penn. Holy moly, all over the world. I mean, they couldn't have helped you out and put them all in Vegas or California, but I guess that's what makes
this fun. Why would they do that?
Yeah, exactly. I guess that makes this fun. Appreciate you squeezing us in very much so. Enjoy the spa. And Michael, I want to tell you this.
Time.
I'm sorry. I'm saying goodbye. I'm saying
great Ariel Helwani. No. We would not do it for anybody else, but for you, my friend, for the MMA hour, it's nothing.
Can I just tell you this, Michael? I was watching the Destiny documentary that they produced about you. I don't know if you've seen this yet. Have you seen it?
Yes, I have. It's quite the complimentary, CJSN.
The nice robe guy. Hey, there's my man. I just wanted to tell you, I was crying. I was literally crying watching this. It was very emotional seeing your family. You know how I feel about your family. I love your son and everything. So it was nice.
It brought tears to my eyes a couple of times as well. So, yeah, no, it was. UFC did a great job on that documentary. So thanks for everybody involved. But this is all about Jason Perillo.
It is. Well, what a sight this is.
This is Daz Morris.
Hello, Daz.
Jason, the big bad Brady Fink. We're here. But we've got a job to do. We can't hang around small talking.
Okay.
Carol, I don't want it.
All right.
You know, I mean, he's too big time these days. But listen, everybody, thank you for the kind words on the My Destiny documentary. It was very good. Jason, I will hand you the phone back now.
No, I'm saying goodbye. I'll say goodbye to you guys.
Those people want to see decrepit Dan Henderson knocked out. Decrepit Dan Henderson will be finished in emphatic style. He will be knocked out cold. Don't miss it. UFC 204, blah, 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 blah.
Come back on Monday after the victory, all right? Because I won't be there, unfortunately.
Right, so
come back. All right.
Deal.
Jason?
Hey, thanks, Errol.
Appreciate it, guys. Enjoy the spa.
Anytime. Thank you, bud. Okay. Take it easy, man.
Jason Perillo there, head coach for one Michael Bisping. I mean, how about that? Champion shows up. I mean, this is something else. What a show it is today. So great stuff there from Jason. Best of luck to him and the rest of the team, Michael Bisping included, on Saturday, UFC 204. Decrepit Dan Henderson. I haven't heard that one before. And I do owe an apology to World Series of Fighting, Sean Al-Shadi, letting me know. Thanks, New York Rick, back there, as I'm going on this rant that they're screwing up another great card by putting it on Saturday. The card is actually Friday. It's October 7th. So I do owe them an apology. I know that sometimes they feel like I'm unfairly critical of their ways, but this time they got it right. It's Friday, October 7th. I apologize. But you can understand why I assumed that it was going to be on Saturday, because they've done it before. In fact, on November 12th, UFC 205, they have a show going up against the most anticipated card maybe in UFC history. So mea culpa. All right? Right? Thanks for the heads up.
Yeah, like you tried to put that on me.
Well, it would be nice if someone was looking out for me.
Now, I imagine this was while I was getting our guest, right?
Potentially.
Yeah, so
any odds we should be looking out for on Saturday before
that's
we go?
That's a good question. How about decrepit Dan Henderson? Does he have a shot?
Wow. Actually, the odds aren't as crazy as I thought they were going to be. Do you know what they are?
Yeah, I do.
Plus
for that 201? Fight. Yeah.
Not bad.
That surprises me a little bit, but I mean, man, I just hate saying puncher's chance, but he has a puncher's chance.
Sure.
And that's about it. I mean, it's really one shot or bust, I think.
Very rare for someone in their first title defense, arguably, and this is no knock on Dan, it's just what the facts have been, the results have been. You look at his last three fights, Michael Bisping, going into this one, so we're including this one, Anderson, Rockhold, Hendo. You can make the case that the title fight is the weakest of the three. You know what I'm saying? As far as the skill, where they're at in their careers and whatnot, but we've seen it before with Mike Brown and Uriah Faber and Benson Henderson and Anthony Pettis. Like, when a guy has someone's number, you got his number.
Yeah, but are we saying that after one?
No, we might find out. Come this time next week, we could be talking about Dan Henderson, UFC champion, knocked him out, whatever, and we'll be like, Dan Henderson has Michael Bisping's number.
Possibly. But I mean,
can't say it now. They've only fought once.
Yeah, and it was what, 2009?
2009, yeah.
Yeah, that's a ways ago.
Musasi's a favorite.
Yeah, Musasi, of course. I think he gets that done for sure.
Manoa is a slight dog.
Yeah, I like Ovince in that fight for sure.
Stefan Struve, a slight favorite.
Also there. I feel like I'm riding chalk for this one.
Brad Pickett, a slight dog.
I think he's live there, you know, because Yuri has these moments of inactivity and just does weird things sometimes in fights, but if he fights to his potential, I think he takes out Brad Pickett.
So Damian Stasiak, a slight dog over Davy Grant. Grant, good to see him back.
Yep. Like, chalk on that.
Rob Font, chalk.
And then Einstein, Albert Tumanov.
That sounds about right. They don't have the other fights. They don't have the Fight Pass fights yet.
I'm glad to see Tumanov back. Exciting fighter. Like to see that.
All right. Anything else?
We're
good.
Yeah, I think that's it.
Shana Tova.
Shana Tova.
Umetuka. That means sweet.
Oh. Yep, sure.
To all of you, I'm going to go home and eat a lot of apples and honey, but for now, I'll say goodbye. Pleasure to do the show. I mean, someone asked me on Twitter, should I put milk in the omelet mix? I don't usually put milk. I know usually when you put milk in the omelet mix, it gets a little fluffier, but I'm not a milk in my eggs kind of guy. Anyway, you can hit my music, by the way. What a fun show it was today. Some breaking news from our friend Guilherme Cruz of MMAfighting.com. Giovanni Decker, the UFC's VP and GM in Brazil, has resigned from the promotion. If you want to learn more about that, go to MMAfighting.com. Well, thank you to everyone who tuned in on this holiday, on this happiest of New Year's. Thank you very much to Eddie Alvarez for stopping by. Thank you very much to Sean Alshadi for stopping by as well. Good luck to Eddie Alvarez at UFC 205. November 12th, baby, 6 blocks from here, Madison Square Garden. The card is officially set. We can stop worrying about it, stop guessing what it will be. It is set, and it is damn good. Kudos to the UFC for putting together such a great card. Thank you very much to Yuani Jacek for stopping by. Always very exciting to talk to her, and she always has a way of getting me more excited for her fights. Little things here or there. Gegard Mousasi, good luck to him at UFC 204 this Saturday. I will not be there, by the way. I will not be in Manchester, I'm sorry to say. But Esther and Casey will be there, so you can expect our same great video and photo coverage this coming week from Manchester. Really wanted to go. Would have been fun, but unfortunately I cannot make it. Juliana Pena, thank you very much to her, and good luck in getting what she wants from the UFC. From the bantamweight division. Thank you very much, Charles Bennett. Best of luck to you, my man. And thank you very much to Jason Perillo. Good luck to him on Saturday night. That does it for us. Same time and place next week. If you missed anything, check it out. iTunes, Stitcher, all that good stuff and more. Until then, peace. Somebody out.